to the grand finale of the 2018-2019 dueling season, the Yu-Gi-Oh! Trading Card Game World Championship live in Berlin. I'm Jerome McHale. I'm here with Matt Bell and Marcello Barberi, and we have got three exciting matches for you today. At the start of this weekend, 28 duelists, 20 Duelings players, and 12 Dragon duelists came to Berlin to find out who is the best duelist of all in the entire world. And by the end of this afternoon, we'll have a winner.
Yeah, three tournaments and three great matches lined up for you guys. We've got one great show planned for you all, and it's going to be an excellent celebration of the last OP season.
Absolutely. We have plenty of good duelists, plenty of good stories. As for every big Yu-Gi-Oh! Event, but in particular for this one, we will have a lot of treats for you guys. Especially because we have the possibility of having not one, but two back-to-back world champions for the TCG and for the Duel Links tournament. I'm excited. I cannot wait to see how these guys will perform. It's an incredible show for you guys.
And it's a fantastic story. We've had repeat champions before, but it's only been in one division. The possibility of a double repeat champion, that could be legendary.
Yeah, and both of these players have been playing excellent the entire weekend.
They really have.
Every game we've casted of these guys, they've shown up on top form. I'm expecting great things from them in these final matches.
All right, so it is going to be an exciting afternoon of dueling here for you today. And, you know, I just don't know what's going to happen. Do we have any last-minute predictions before we get the festivities started? Do you think we're actually going to see the double repeat?
Just for the sake of it being so amazing, I really want to wish that it is going to happen. And the really cool thing is that in the Dragon Duel, there is also the TCG World Champion friend playing the same card-by-card decklist. So maybe, and it's my prediction, it is going to happen. We're going to have two back-to-back champions and the Dragon Duel from Taiwan.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Now, that is teamwork, working together, building your decks.
Absolutely.
And that's one of the great things about the World Championship is that, you know, once the players finish things off at the World Championship qualifier, they can set aside their differences and come together to try to build the best possible decks to get the job done on the World Championship. So get ready. The World Championship Finals are about to begin.
It's time to duel! Welcome! Welcome to the Yu-Gi-Oh! World Champion Series 2019 in Berlin, Germany. Yu-Gi-Oh! And I, yes, Berlin, Germany! Yugi and I have traveled far and wide to witness some of the greatest duelists in history. However, this is the first time we have been here in Europe to witness such a prestigious event. Isn't it, Yugi?
That's right, Pharaoh. Qualifying for this tournament isn't easy. And making it to the finals is even harder. The duelists we've seen so far have been incredible. And I'm sure that the duels ahead will be even better. All of the participants should be really proud of themselves. I think it would be a great time to introduce all of these duelists, starting with my favorite, the Dragon Duelists. Hey, you ready? Hikaru Katada from Japan. Takuma Awatsaka, Japan. Sojin Kim, South Korea. Chang-On Soon, Taiwan. Timothy Newton, Australia. Felix Rau, Germany. Eric Topol, Germany. Vitas Krohg, Denmark. Lucas Oswald, USA. And Jacob Elson, USA. Victor Alfonso Gonzalez, Mexico. Diego Orlando Romero Hernandez, Peru. Congratulations to you all for making it to the Yu-Gi-Oh! Dragon Duel World Championship! Yeah! I'm sure some of you would be able to take me on even with the power of my Millennium Puzzle. Best of luck to the finalists. Now, I think it's time to introduce the Yu-Gi-Oh! Duel Links Duelists. We got some fans over there, I see. Starting with Takahiro Hamada, Japan, 2018 champion. Takamura Matsumura, Japan. Raichi Kitahara, Japan. Naoya Shimomura, Japan. Yuya Aoyama, Japan. Masaaki Nita, Japan. Shuhei Kobayashi, Japan. Jonghwan Lee, Korea. Chun Man Poon, Hong Kong. Ogyen Height, Germany. Andreas Gerlach, Germany. Alberto Marané, Spain. Mohamed Hassan, Egypt. A personal favorite of mine. Eduardo Augusto Maragoni de Vasconcelos, Brazil. Vinicius Enrique Manjeas Poyati, Brazil. Rafael Jose Rodriguez de Sousa, Brazil. Andy Tong, USA. Robert Tanney, USA. Jason Chu, USA. Congratulations to all of you for making it to the Yu-Gi-Oh! Duel Links World Championships. Time for these duelists to harness the power of my Destiny draw skill. Now, if you would please exit the stage. Thank you. Give them a big hand. They deserve it. And now, as I'm sure you all have been waiting for, it's time for our last batch of finalists. Here are your Yu-Gi-Oh! TCG World Championship duelists. First up, we have... What's going on? I've never seen this before. What is this? Wait a minute. Oh, no!
Prototype Command, initiating dual dome launch conversion. Over.
Roger, Dome Command. Prepare all stations for immediate dragon flight. Over.
That's affirmative. We show Mr. Kaiba now approaching primary flight deck. Opening hangar doors. Blue-Eyes White Jet, you are cleared for takeoff.
I hope you know what you're doing, big brother.
I was just hoping the same thing.
You think I've got it all? Everyone thinks I've got it made well. How come my only friends are the ones I pay? No one understands what I would do to change my life for just one day.
What would be a world championship be without me? The world's greatest duelist! It's Kaiba. You know, you've had enough time on the stage, Yugi, so now it's my turn. Before we get to business with you, Yugi, let's get it over with and bring out these third-rate duelists.
Kaiba, these are the greatest duelists in the world, in the whole world. I bet any of them could defeat you.
Yeah, they're not worthy of a chance to duel against me, Yugi, but if you insist, I, Seto Kaiba, greatest duelist in the world, will announce their names. Chia Chang Wang. Charlie Futch III. Kei Murakoshi. Kohei Tsukumitsu. Koli Kosaka. Kotari Yamagichi. Yuyon Yun. Angelo Espiritu. Lauren Vidad. Charles Liu. Honor Giza. Jake Quincy. Herman Hansen. Gabriel Susi. Samir Bakar. Jonas Koschel. Joshua Schmidt. Raphael Nevin. Jesse Cotton. Gabriel Antonio Vargas. Dakota Angeloff. Raymond Young Dai. Wei Lee. Manav Dewar. Angel Fernando Ovalle. Galileo de Abaldalia. Nicholas Vera. And Michael Luiz.
Congratulations to all of you who made it to this year's Yu-Gi-Oh! TCG World Championship.
Hey, that was my line, Yugi. They have already received the greatest congratulations in all Duel Monsters to be in my presence.
I don't particularly enjoy your presence, Kaiba.
Me neither. You know, let's take these champions to see my grandpa for some last-minute deck tuning before their finals.
That sounds good. Like a great idea. Let's go. Come on, duelists. This way.
Typical Yugi. Running away from me. I hope he realizes I will make him pay for turning his back on me. However, it doesn't mean that the stage is now perfectly set. It means it is, because it's 100% Kaiba. Yeah, okay. I can only think of one more thing that might be needed to... It's my blue eyes, white dragon. Now we're talking! Oh, no. Come on. He had his time. Is he back already?
Yeah. That's me. Kaiba, I am not going to leave you here alone with these people after you insulted those champions.
The stage was so much better a few seconds ago.
You may insult them, but they have more courage and belief in the heart of the cards than you ever will. I will do what I must for these prestigious duelists. I challenge you to a duel!
Why else do you think I'm here, Yugi?
It's time to duel!
I'll start this duel off with my Cards of Consonance spell card. This card lets me discard the White Stone of Ancients from my hand and draw two cards. Next, I activate Dragon Shrine. This card lets me send one dragon-type monster from my deck to my graveyard. Then, if that dragon is a normal monster, I get to send one more dragon-type monster from my deck to my graveyard. First, I'll send Luster Dragon number 2 to my graveyard. Then, I'll send the White Stone of Legend to my graveyard. Now the effect of the White Stone of Legend activates, and it's sent to the graveyard. I get to add a blue-eyes white dragon to my hand.
Impressive. It's your first turn, and you've already managed to add a blue-eyes white dragon to your hand.
Yes. Well, that's just the beginning, Yugi. If you're impressed by that, you're going to be blown away by the next turn. Next, I activate trade-in. I discard the blue-eyes white dragon in my hand and draw two more cards from my deck. Now I summon Kaiba Man.
Kaiba Man?
Are you stunned by how handsome this monster is?
Or
maybe you're just left speechless by Kaiba Man's awesome sense of style.
Yeah. I don't think that's it.
Well, get your last look in because he's not staying on the field for long. I tribute Kaiba Man to summon a blue-eyes white dragon from my hand.
Oh, no! It's only the first turn, and you already have a blue-eyes on the field.
That's right, Yugi. And if one blue-eyes white dragon worries you, what chances do you have against two? I activate Silver's Cry. This card lets me special summon a blue-eyes white dragon back from the graveyard. Take flight, my second blue-eyes white dragon!
Two blue-eyes white dragons?
And I'm not finished yet, Yugi. I set one card face down and then enter my end phase. In my end phase, the effect of the White Stone of Ancients activates. Since I discarded it earlier in my turn, I can special summon my third blue-eyes white dragon from my deck.
All three blue-eyes white dragons.
Is this familiar to you, Yugi? The sight of my three blue-eyes white dragons staring you down? It's been way too long, but now I have you right where I want you. It's your move.
I draw. First, I activate Pot of Greed. This card lets me draw two cards from my deck. I've drawn Wadapon. I activate Wadapon's effect to special summon to the field, but it won't be staying there for long. I tribute Wadapon to summon the Dark Magician Girl.
I feel bad for her. She's no match for my dragons.
Then it's time to enlist some help. I activate Sage's Stone. Since Dark Magician Girl is on my field, this card lets me special summon the Dark Magician from my deck.
You think your Dark Magician will save you?
Maybe not alone, but with Dark Magician Girl on my field alongside it, I have everything I need. I set a card face down. Now, I activate my spell card, Dark Burning Magic.
Dark Burning Magic?
I can use this spell card only while Dark Magician and Dark Magician Girl are on my field. But since they are, my Dark Burning Magic destroys all cards on your field.
No way!
You're finished! My Dark Burning Magic will annihilate every single card on your field.
This can't be happening!
I'm disappointed, Kaiba. You thoughtlessly filled your field with everything you could amass, making yourself vulnerable to my Dark Burning Magic spell card, and now you're left with nothing to defend your life points against the attack from my magicians. Dark Magician and Dark Magician Girl, attack Kaiba's life points directly and end this duel! Double Dark Magic attack!
You didn't think I'd go down that easily, did you? I always have a backup plan. I will have my revenge, Yugi, and my comeback begins with this card. Goddess of Sweet Revenge! Since I have no other cards left on the field or in my hand, I discard Goddess of Sweet Revenge to destroy all cards on your field.
Oh, no!
That's right, Yugi. Both of your magicians are destroyed, along with your face-down card. Next, my Goddess of Sweet Revenge lets me special summon any monster from my deck. I special summon Deep Eyes White Dragon. If I summon Deep Eyes White Dragon, it gains the attack points of any dragon in my graveyard. Since my Blue Eyes White Dragon is in my graveyard, my Deep Eyes has 3,000 attack points. Revenge is so sweet, isn't it? Now your field is empty, and I have the strongest monster once more.
My field may be empty at the moment, but it won't be for long. When you use the effect of your Goddess of Sweet Revenge, you destroyed my Chaos Scepter Blast.
So?
That means my Chaos Scepter Blast's effect activates. Mm. If it's destroyed, I get to special summon a Dark Magician of Chaos from my deck. Come forth, Dark Magician of Chaos! My Dark Magician of Chaos has 2,800 attack points and an incredible effect. When it's summoned, I get to add any spell card from my graveyard to my hand. I'll return Pot of Greed to my hand.
Your Dark Magicians of Chaos is still no match for my dragon.
Next, I'll activate Pot of Greed to draw two cards. I set one card face down and end my turn.
It's my turn. I draw. Perfect. I activate Card of Demise. Now I draw until I have 5 cards in my hand. As long as I discarded my hand in 5 turns. But there's no way this duel will last that long, Yugi. I'll defeat you long before that happens.
We'll see about that.
Next, I activate the effect of the White Stone of Ancients. By banishing it from my graveyard, I get to add a Blue Eyes White Dragon from my graveyard to my hand. Now I reveal the Blue Eyes White Dragon from my hand to special summon Blue Eyes Alternative White Dragon. I can't special summon Blue Eyes Alternative White Dragon from my hand simply by revealing a Blue Eyes White Dragon. Plus, my Blue Eyes Alternative White Dragon has a special effect. Once per turn, I can control and destroy it. I'll activate my dragon's effect to destroy your Dark Magician of Chaos.
Not so fast, Kaiba. When you target a spellcaster on my field with a card effect, I get to special summon Palladium Oracle Mana from my hand. Come forth, Palladium Oracle Mana! As long as Palladium Oracle Mana is on my field, my level 7 or higher spellcasters can't be destroyed by card effects. That means my Dark Magician of Chaos is perfectly safe.
For now, but I'm not finished. I summon the King of Dragons! Next, I activate the King of Dragons effect. When it's normal summoned, I can discard a spell or trap card and add one of three different spell cards to my hand. I'll discard a spell card to add Dragon Revival Rhapsody to my hand. Now, I activate Dragon Revival Rhapsody. I can only use this card while I control a spellcaster-type monster, but as luck would have it, the King of Dragons is a spellcaster. This card lets me special summon two dragons from my graveyard as long as at least one of them is a normal monster. I'll special summon two Blue Eyes White Dragons back to the field.
Oh, no.
Now it's time to battle. Blue Eyes Deep Dragon, attack and destroy Yugi's Dark Magician of Chaos.
I activate my trap card, Mirror Force. Your monster's attack is reflected right back at you. All of your monsters are now destroyed.
Not so fast, Yugi. I guess you didn't see this, the card I discarded when I activated the King of Dragons effect. The card I discarded was Return of the Dragon Lords. And this spell card has a special effect that I can activate from the graveyard anytime one or more of my dragons would be destroyed by battle or card effect. I can banish Return of the Dragon Lords from my graveyard to protect them. I'll use its effect to protect all of the dragons on my field. Since the King of Dragons isn't a dragon, it's destroyed by your Mirror Force, but the rest of my monsters are safe. Now, Blue Eyes Deep Dragon, continue your attack. Luckily for you, you don't take any damage during the turn. I activate Dragon Revival Rhapsody. That means your life points are safe. But I can't say the same for your magician. Your Dark Magician of Chaos is destroyed.
When my Dark Magician of Chaos leaves the field, it's banished from the duel.
Now, Blue Eyes White Dragon, destroy Palladium Oracle Mana, White Lightning Attack! Your Palladium Oracle Mana is destroyed.
That means her effect activates. If she's destroyed by battle or by card effect, I get to special summon Dark Magician Girl from my hand, deck, or graveyard. Come forth, Dark Magician Girl!
It makes no difference. My second Blue Eyes White Dragon still hasn't attacked. White Lightning! Your Dark Magician Girl is destroyed. You have nothing left on your field. I set two cards face down and end my turn. It's your move.
I draw. First, I activate Dark Magic Veil. By giving up 1,000 life points, I can special summon a dark spellcaster from my hand or graveyard. Return to my field, Dark Magician! Next, I activate my spell card, Bond Between Teacher and Student. Now that the teacher is on the field, his student will follow. Since I control the Dark Magician, this card lets me special summon the Dark Magician Girl from my graveyard. Then, I get to set a spell card from my deck, and I choose Dark Burning Attack. But it's not staying face down for long. Since the Dark Magician Girl is on my field, I can activate it. My Dark Burning Attack destroys all monsters on your field, Kaiba.
All of them?
That's right. You have no monsters left on your field to defend.
That may be. But by destroying my Deep Eyes White Dragon, you activated its effect.
Deep Eyes White Dragon has another effect?
When it's destroyed by a card effect, all monsters on your field are destroyed.
Oh, no!
Oh, yes. Bid farewell to your magicians.
My Dark Magician and Dark Magician Girl may be destroyed, but my turn is just beginning. I activate Card of Sanctity. Now, we each draw from our decks until we have six cards in our hand. I've drawn Palladium Oracle Mahat. When I draw Mahat, I can special summon him to the field. Come forth, Mahat. Next, I activate a ritual spell card, Chaos Form. By banishing the level 7 Dark Magician from my graveyard, I can now ritual summon an even more powerful spellcaster. I banish the Dark Magician from my graveyard to call forth my ritual monster, Magician of Chaos. Next, I activate Upstart Goblin. This card increases your life points by 1,000 and lets me draw a card. But first, I'll chain the effect of my Magician of Chaos. Once per turn, if a spell or trap card or effect is activated while Magician of Chaos is on the field, I can target one card on the field and destroy it. Now, Magician of Chaos, strike down Kaiba's face-down card on the left.
You've targeted my Ring of Destruction. I chain it to the effect of your Magician of Chaos and target your magician. My Ring of Destruction will destroy your magician, and when it does, we'll both take damage equal to the attack points of your magician. That means we each lose 2,500 life points.
Don't be so sure about that, Kaiba. I activate the effect of the Palladium Oracle Mana in my graveyard.
Palladium Oracle Mana has an effect in the graveyard?
Since you targeted a spellcaster on my field, I can special summon Palladium Oracle Mana from my graveyard. Return to my field!
Oh no!
Now that she's on my field, my level 7 or larger or higher spellcasters can't be destroyed by card effects. That makes my Magician of Chaos immune to your Ring of Destruction. You know what that means, Kaiba. Mm. Now my magician and my life points are perfectly safe. Now that that's taken care of, my upstart goblin can finally resolve. I'll increase your life points by 1,000 to draw a card from my deck. It's over, Kaiba. Even though you still have 5,000 life points, my magicians have a combined attack power of 7,000. Mana, Mahad, and Magician of Chaos, attack Kaiba directly and end this duel.
That would end the duel if it weren't for my face down card. That is, I activate Negate Attack. Your attack is negated and your battle phase immediately ends.
Well done, Kaiba.
Thank you.
You've bought yourself another turn. But I still have 3 powerful magicians on my field, and you're left with nothing. It's your move.
I draw. Yugi, I maybe have nothing on my field, but thanks to your card of sanctity, my hand is full. First, I'll activate this spell card, Forbidden Chalice. This card lets me negate the effects of one monster on the field and increase its attack by 400. I'll target your Palladium Oracle Mana. I don't want its pesky effect getting in the way with the rest of my turn.
Ugh.
Next, I activate Dragon's Mirror. Ugh. This spell card lets me fusion summon a dragon from my extra deck by banishing its fusion materials from my graveyard. I banish Blue Eyes Alternative White Dragon and 2 Blue Eyes White Dragons from my graveyard.
Oh, no.
Come forth, Blue Eyes Alternative Ultimate Dragon.
Blue Eyes Alternative Ultimate Dragon?
My Blue Eyes Alternative Ultimate Dragon has 4,500 attack points and 3,800 defense points, just like my Blue Eyes Ultimate Dragon. But unlike my ordinary Blue Eyes Ultimate Dragon, this new and improved version is an effect monster. If I fusion summon it by using Blue Eyes Alternative White Dragon as a fusion material once per turn, my Blue Eyes Alternative Ultimate Dragon can destroy 3 cards on your field. Since that's how I summoned it, I'll activate that effect. Blue Eyes Alternative Ultimate Dragon, destroy all three of Yugi's monsters!
Now, who's defenseless, Yugi? What? What?
My monsters may be gone, but their legacy will live on. I activate the effects of all three of my monsters. First, when my Palladium Oracle mana is destroyed, I get to special summon Dark Magician from my hand, deck, or graveyard.
But you don't have a Dark Magician in your hand, deck, or graveyard. I've studied up on your deck and your strategies, Yugi, and I know that you only have one Dark Magician, and you banished it with Chaos Form.
Don't I? Look again, Kaiba. While my Magician of Chaos is on my field or is in my graveyard, its name becomes the Dark Magician. That means I can special summon it with Mahad's effect. Next, I use the effect of Palladium Oracle Mana. Since she's destroyed, I get to special summon Dark Magician Girl from my hand, deck, or graveyard. Return, Dark Magician Girl! Finally, I use the effect of my Magician of Chaos. Since you destroyed it by battle or by card effect after it was ritual summoned to the field, I get to special summon one Chaos or Black Luster Soldier ritual monster from my hand, ignoring its summoning condition. Come forth, Magician of Black Chaos, Max! My three magicians have been replaced by three more.
For now. But they won't last on the field for long. I banish the King of Dragons and Deep Eyes White Dragon from my graveyard to special summon Chaos Emperor Dragon, Envoy of the End! My Chaos Emperor Dragon has 3,000 attack points, and I can special summon it simply by banishing a dark and a light monster from my graveyard. Since the King of Dragons is a dark monster and Deep Eyes White Dragon is a light monster, they're the perfect pair for summoning this powerful dragon. Next, I activate this spell card, Dimension Fusion. By paying 2,000 life points, this card lets us special summon to the field as many banished monsters as possible. Return to the field, Deep Eyes White Dragon, Blue Eyes Alternative White Dragon, and two more Blue Eyes White Dragons.
Impossible! You have 6 monsters on the field. You can only have up to 5 monsters on the field. Explain yourself, Kaiba.
I guess you aren't familiar with the latest dueling rules, Yugi. Ordinarily, a duelist can only have 5 monsters on the field in their main monster zones. But now, each duelist also has access to an extra monster zone, specifically for monsters special summoned from the extra deck. As you can see, since my Blue Eyes Alternative Ultimate Dragon was special summoned from the extra deck, it's in the extra monster zone. That leaves room for 5 more dragons on the field for a total of 6.
Incredible. But I'm not out of this duel yet, Kaiba. Thanks to your dimension fusion, I special summon my banished Dark Magician and Dark Magician of Chaos back to the field.
Now that our monsters are back on the field, their effects activate. I'll use my Deep Eyes White Dragon's effect to copy the 2,400 attack points of the Luster Dragon 2 in my graveyard.
My Dark Magician of Chaos's effect also activates when it's summoned, allowing me to return a special card from my graveyard to my hand. I return Card of Sanctity.
Now my monsters enter into battle. Deep Eyes White Dragon, attack and destroy Yugi's Magician of Chaos. Chaos Emperor Dragon, attack and destroy Magician of Black Chaos Max. Blue Eyes Alternative White Dragon, attack and destroy Dark Magician of Chaos. And Blue Eyes White Dragons, attack and destroy Yugi's Dark Magician and Dark Magician Girl. Double White
Lightning attack!
Fortunately for you, since my ultimate dragon used its effect this turn, it can't attack. But I still have 6 monsters on my field, and you have 0. In a duel between the two of us, our fields look exactly the way I'd expect them to look, Yugi. I set 2 cards face down and end my turn. It's your move.
I draw. First, I set 3 cards face down. Next, I activate Card of Sanctity. Once again, we each draw until we have 6 cards in our hands. And I'm not done drawing cards yet, Kaiba. Now, I activate Pot of Desires. I banish the top 10 cards of my deck face down to draw 2 cards.
You'll need all the cards you can get.
I'll continue my turn by activating a new spell card, Ledger of Ledger Domain. This card lets me banish the top 3 cards of my deck face down. During my third standby phase, after activating this card, I get to add 3 of those banished cards to my hand. I have you exactly where I want you, Kaiba. I activate my face-down card, Polymerization. I fuse together my Crystal Seer, Old Vindictive Magician, Apprentice Illusion Magician, Mystical Elf, and Droll and Lockbird.
5 monsters!
I fusion summon Quintet Magician! My Quintet Magician can be fusion summoned by combining any 5 spellcasters. And unfortunately for you, as soon as it strikes the field, its effect activates. Since it was summoned by combining the spellcasters with different names, all cards on your field are destroyed. Quintet Magician, strike down all of Kaiba's monsters and the cards in his back row.
Hang on. I activate my trap card, Gift of the Mystical Elf. This card increases my life points by 300 for each monster on both sides of the field. Since there are 7 monsters on the field, I gain 2,100 life points.
You may have gotten a life points boost, but your monsters and remaining back row card are still destroyed.
Oh, no!
What's this? Your ultimate dragon is still on the field.
That's right, Yugi. You may have destroyed the rest of my monsters, but my Blue Eyes alternative ultimate dragon has another effect. My ultimate dragon can't be targeted or destroyed by your card effects. That means your Quintet Magician's effect is powerless against it.
Even so, your other 5 monsters are now gone.
Which reminds me, I activate the effect of my Deep Eyes White Dragon. As you already know, since it's destroyed, so are all of the monsters on your field. Say goodbye to your Quintet Magician.
It's a bit too early for that, Kaiba. I guess you aren't aware of my Quintet Magician's other effect.
Other effect?
Like your Blue Eyes alternative ultimate dragon, my Quintet Magician can't be destroyed by card effects. That means your Deep Eyes White Dragon's effect is powerless against it.
Ah!
And like your ultimate dragon, my Quintet Magician has 4,500 attack points, which means our 2 monsters are evenly matched. But before they clash, I'm summoning Sangin to the field. Now, Quintet Magician, attack and destroy Kaiba's ultimate dragon.
Blue Eyes alternative ultimate dragon counterattack.
Your dragon is destroyed. Now, Sangin, attack Kaiba directly. Since Sangin has 1,000 attack points, you lose 1,000 life points. I end my turn.
I draw. First, I activate Pot of Greed. This card lets me draw 2 cards from my deck. Next, I activate Swing of Memories. This card lets me special summon a normal monster from my graveyard. Take flight, Blue Eyes White Dragon! Next, I activate the effect of my Neo Kaiser Glider. By discarding it from my hand, along with one other monster, I can special summon another normal monster from my graveyard. I discard my Neo Kaiser Glider and Kaiser Vorce Raider. Return to me, Blue Eyes White Dragon! Now, my Neo Kaiser Glider's other effect activates, and it's sent to the graveyard. All monsters you control lose 500 attack points until the end phase. That means your Sangin is down to just 500 attack points. Oh, and my turn isn't even close to being finished, Yugi. I activate polymerization.
Ugh.
I fuse the Blue Eyes White Dragon in my hand with the two on my field. Come forth, Neo Blue Eyes Ultimate Dragon! My new dragon has 4,500 attack points. You're finished, Yugi. Neo Blue Eyes Ultimate Dragon, attack Yugi Sangin and end this duel!
I activate my trap card, Magic Cylinder. This card negates your monster's attack and inflicts damage to your life points equal to your monster's attack points. And since your monster has 4,500 attack points, but you only have 4,100 life points, this duel is over.
You know, you're so predictable. I knew you'd try something like that, Yugi. That's why I was prepared. I activate Diffusion from my hand. This card splits my ultimate dragon back into three Blue Eyes White Dragons that were used to summon it. Your magic cylinder is rendered powerless. Now I have three Blue Eyes White Dragons against your tiny Sangin. Blue Eyes White Dragon, attack and destroy Yugi Sangin.
If you want to destroy my Sangin, you'll have to find him first. I activate magical hats. My Sangin is hiding under one of those four hats. And before your dragons can get to my life points, you'll have to find my Sangin. Take your best shot, Kaiba.
All right. Blue Eyes White Dragon, attack the rightmost hat.
That's a miss.
Okay, all right. Now my second Blue Eyes gets to attack. Attack the middle hat.
Better luck next time.
Fine. My third Blue Eyes White Dragon can still attack. Attack the hat on the left!
You finally destroyed my Sangin, but unfortunately for you, that activates its effect. Now I can add any monster with 1,500 or fewer attack points from my deck to my hand. I choose Curry Bandit! Since it's obvious that my last hat is empty, and all three of your dragons have already attacked, I'll dispel my final hat.
You may have survived one more turn, Yugi, but there's no way you'll win this duel. I set one card face down and a monster in defense mode. It's your move.
I draw. I begin my turn by summoning Curry Bandit to the field. Now, I tribute it to activate its effect. Curry Bandit's effect lets me reveal the top five cards of my deck. Any spell or trap cards revealed are added to my hand. Any monsters revealed are sent to the graveyard. I reveal Overdone Burial, Diffusion Wave Motion, Magic Formula, Electromagnetic Turtle, and Clear Karibo. My Electromagnetic Turtle and Clear Karibo are sent to the graveyard, but the rest of the cards are added to my hand. Next, I discard Sorcerer of Dark Magic from my hand to activate Overdone Burial. I can activate Overdone Burial by discarding a monster from my hand. Then, Overdone Burial special summons a monster from my graveyard
with a level lower than that level of the discarded monster. The effect of the monster I special summon with overdone burial has its effect negated. Since I discarded my level 9 sorcerer of dark magic to activate overdone burial, I can special summon my level 7 magician of chaos back to the field. Next, I equip my magician of chaos with magic formula. This spell card increases my spellcaster's attack points by 700, bringing it up to 3,200. That makes my magician of chaos the strongest monster on the field.
You may have the strongest monster on the field, but my monsters still outnumber yours 4-1.
But they won't for long, Kaiba. I give up 1,000 life points to activate Diffusion Wave Motion. Diffusion Wave Motion forces a level 7 or higher spellcaster on my field to attack all monsters you control. Plus, the effects of any monsters destroyed by their attacks can't activate and are negated. Your 4-1 advantage is about to be eliminated. My Magician of Chaos will attack all of your monsters. I'll start with a blue-eyes white dragon. Now, I'll attack another blue-eyes. And now, your third blue-eyes.
Come on!
Finally, my Magician of Chaos attacks your face-down monster. Your field of monsters is vanquished, Kaiba. What's so funny?
Oh, listen. By destroying my giant germ, you fell right into my trap.
Impossible. Your giant germ's effect is negated thanks to the effect of my diffusion wave motion.
I wasn't trying to use my giant germ's effect, Yugi. I just needed you to destroy it so that I could activate this card. Crush Card Virus!
What have you done, Kaiba?
I wasn't trying to infect your deck with a germ, Yugi. I wanted to infect it with a virus. The deadliest virus in all of Duel Monsters. And it looks like I succeeded. When you destroy one of my dark monsters with 1,000 or fewer attack points in battle, I can activate this trap card. And since my giant germ is a dark fiend with 1,000 attack points, it fits the bill. As we speak, my crush card virus is infecting your hand, your field, and your deck. Now, for the rest of this duel, any monster in your hand that has a draw with 1,500 or more attack points is immediately destroyed. Plus, any monster on your field with 1,500 or more attack points is immediately destroyed. And don't even think about special summoning any monsters with 1,500 or more attack points, Yugi, because guess what? They'll be immediately destroyed too.
This can't be.
You fell right into my trap, Yugi. Attacking my giant germ with your Magician of Chaos marks the beginning of the end for you, and the first victim of my trap card is your Magician of Chaos. Since it's on the field right now and has way more than 1,500 attack points, guess what? It's immediately destroyed.
Oh, my Magician.
Face it, Yugi. Without access to your best cards, you don't stand a chance. Not even the Egyptian gods could save you now.
He's right, Pharaoh. We just lost our best strategies. How are we going to win this?
It doesn't look good, Yugi. But we have to trust our deck and find a way to win. We can't give up.
You're right, Pharaoh. I believe in you.
When my Magician of Chaos was destroyed, so was my magic formula. And when my magic formula is sent from my field to the graveyard, I gain 1,000 life points.
1,000 more life points will make no difference at all, Yugi. Not anymore. Nothing will stop the crush card virus from tearing apart your deck. And nothing will stop me from winning this duel.
I end my turn.
I draw. How pitiful. You ended your turn without a single card on your field, but I guess that's the best you can do with my crush card virus devastating your deck. I assure you, Yugi, my turn will be far more impressive. First, I activate Pot of Extravagance. I banish 6 random cards face down from my extra deck to draw 2 cards. Now, for the rest of the turn, I can't draw cards from my deck, but that won't be a problem. I activate Chaos Form. This card didn't do you a lot of good, Yugi, but I'll make sure to make better use of it. I banish a Blue-Eyes White Dragon from my graveyard to ritual summon Blue-Eyes Chaos Max Dragon from my hand.
4,000 attack points.
That's right, Yugi. And it also has a couple of effects that you might want to hear about. First, my Blue-Eyes Chaos Max Dragon can't be targeted or destroyed by your card effects. Second, anytime it attacks a defense position monster, it inflicts double piercing battle damage.
Incredible.
It's over, Yugi. Since you only have 3,000 life points left, one direct attack will finish you off. Blue-Eyes Chaos Max Dragon, attack Yugi directly and end this duel.
It's not over yet, Kaiba. I activate the effect of the Clear Karibo in my graveyard. By banishing it from my graveyard, I get to draw 1 card from my deck. If it's a monster, I can special summon it to the field. I draw. I've drawn Karibo. Instead of special summoning it to the field, I'll activate its effect. I discard it from my hand to take no battle damage from your Blue-Eyes Chaos Max Dragon.
Face it, Yugi. You're only delaying the inevitable defeat. You have no cards in your hand or on your field. Defeating my Blue-Eyes Chaos Max Dragon will be impossible. Maybe you could have defeated it if your monsters weren't infected with my crush card virus. But with my crush card virus in effect, you don't stand a chance. It's your move.
He's right. I've considered every card combination remaining in our deck. There's no way for us to defeat his Blue-Eyes Chaos Max Dragon.
Maybe not, but we can still find a way to win. It's like you said, Pharaoh. We can't give up.
I draw. I activate Draw of Fate. If my life points are lower than yours, and you control the strongest monster on the field, I can activate my Draw of Fate spell card. This card lets me select 3 cards from my deck and put them on the top of my deck in random order. Then, I get to draw 1 of those cards. And for the rest of the turn, I can't set any spell or trap cards and can't activate more than 1 card or effect.
Clever move, Yugi. By manipulating your next 3 draws, you can guarantee that you won't draw a monster susceptible to my crush card virus. But if you think that will be enough to save you in this duel, oh man, you're delusional.
I draw a card with my Draw of Fate. I end my turn.
Another turn wasted. It's my move. I draw. Perfect. I activate Monster Reborn. This card lets me special summon a monster from either graveyard. I choose my Blue-Eyes alternative, Ultimate Dragon. Remember my Ultimate Dragon? It has 4,500 attack points, 3,800 defense points, and it can't be targeted or destroyed by your card effects. Yeah. Alongside my Chaos Max Dragon, I'd say your odds of winning have just been cut in half. But what's half of 0 anyway, Yugi? Blue-Eyes Alternative Ultimate Dragon, attack Yugi directly and end this duel.
This duel isn't over yet, Kaiba. I activate the effect of my Electromagnetic Turtle. By banishing it from my graveyard, I end the battle phase. It looks like
I'll be getting another turn.
If you insist. Go ahead and take another turn. Draw your last pathetic card, Yugi.
This is it. There's only one card we can draw here to turn this duel around. What if we don't draw it, Pharaoh? We can't think like that, Yugi. It's like your grandfather always says, we just have to trust in the heart of the cards. Then, anything is possible. You're right. Heart of the cards, guide me. I draw. Since these turns have passed, since I activated my ledger of ledger domain, I add these cards I banished with its effect to my hand. Now, I have the perfect five cards I need to defeat you, Kaiba.
You're bluffing.
Am I? I activate this spell card, Burial from a Different Dimension. This card allows me to return three banished cards to their owner's graveyard. I'll use it to return the White Stone of Ancients, Blue Eyes White Dragon, and the King of Dragons to your graveyard. Next, I activate Soul Release. This card lets me banish any five cards that I choose from any graveyards. I banish Giant Germ from your graveyard and banish Mystical Elf, Droll and Lockin' Bird, Karibo, and Old Vindictive Magician from my graveyard.
What are you planning?
You're about to find out. I discard Dark Magic Twin Burst from my hand to activate Double Spell. By discarding a spell card from my hand, Double Spell lets me select a spell card in your graveyard and activate it on my side of the field. I choose your Dimension Fusion. I give up 2,000 life points to force both of us to special summon as many banished monsters as possible.
Have you forgotten that any monster you summon with more than 1,500 attack points will be immediately destroyed?
I'm not planning to summon any monsters with more than 1,500 attack points, Kaiba. I special summon Clear Karibo, Electromagnetic Turtle, Mystical Elf, Droll, and Lockin' Bird, and Karibo. Since each of these monsters have fewer than 1,500 attack points, they're all unaffected by your Crush Card virus. And since your Giant Germ is banished from the duel, you must special summon it to your field.
Fine. I'll summon it in attack mode.
Now, I have you right where I want you.
Impossible! What's the last card in your hand?
I tribute Clear Karibo, Electromagnetic Turtle, Mystical Elf, Droll and Lockbird, and Karibo. I've told you once, and I'll tell you again, Kaiba, my deck has no pathetic cards. But once again, it does contain the unstoppable Exodia! Come forth, Exodia, the legendary defender!
Exodia? How can this be?
Exodia, the legendary defender, is a new addition to my deck. I can tribute summon it by tributing the monsters from my field, and if I do, Exodia the Legendary Defender gains attack points and defense points equal to the total attack points of the monsters tributed. I carefully selected the monsters to tribute so that their combined attack points, our total, is higher than that of the stats of your Giant Germ, but lower than 1,500. Since two of the monsters I tributed have zero attack points, two of them have 300 attack points, and the last one has 800 attack points. My Exodia, the legendary defender, has 1,400 attack points, making it unaffected by your Crush Card virus.
That Exodia is nothing like the real thing. Its feeble stats just barely make it strong enough to defeat my Giant Germ. On my next turn, my two dragons will wipe out Exodia, as well as whatever is left
of your life points.
There won't be a next turn, Kaiba. Exodia, the legendary defender, also has a special effect. When it destroys a dark fiend in battle, I automatically win the duel. And since your giant germ is a dark fiend...
No way!
Yes way. The very monster you relied on to infect my deck with the Crush Card virus was also the weak link that has assured your defeat, Kaiba. Now, all I have to do to win this duel is attack your giant germ with Exodia, the legendary defender.
This can't be happening.
Exodia, obliterate!
I can't believe I lost.
Don't be upset, Kaiba. It was an incredible duel that I'll never forget, and neither will everyone watching it.
Yeah, that's what I'm afraid of.
As long as we created an incredible memory for ourselves and for the people around us, our duel was a total success.
It sure was an exciting duel, but I wanted to win the title. This was my chance, my redemption. How could I let this happen?
You'll have plenty of time to figure that out as you're planning for our next unforgettable duel. But for now, let's not forget that no one is here for us, Kaiba. Everyone is here for them. We're all here to see which 2019 World Championship competitor will earn the right to be called World Champion.
You're right, Yugi. Now it's our turn to watch some exciting duels.
And it's our turn to see who's the best.
我叫做孙尚恩，今年十二岁，来自台湾。就是因为爸爸在卖卡，然后我接触游戏王。一整个句子哦，我是一个搞笑的人。对这边的食物感觉得很不习惯，获得了台湾代表。我叫做孙尚恩，今年十二岁，来自台湾。就是因为爸爸在卖卡，然后我接触游戏王。一整个句子哦，我是一个搞笑的人。对这边的食物感觉得很不习惯，获得了台湾代表。
And now, it is my honor to introduce our first two duelists, Vitus Krog and Sun Shang En.
Mit navn er Vitus Krog, og jeg kommer fra Danmark. Jeg så Yu-Gi-Oh-serien, som jeg fandt på Netflix, og det var sådan, jeg kom ind i spillet. Det var nok til Europamesterskabet, fordi det var bare rigtig sjovt, og jeg mødte mange nye mennesker. Jeg kan godt lide at spille håndbold og være sammen med min familie. Og grunden til, at jeg godt kan lide at spille håndbold, det er fordi, at jeg godt kan lide at spille sport og bevæge mig.
All right, it's time to get ourselves some champions, and we are going to start with the Dragon Duelists. Sun Shang En and Vitus Krog.
Okay.
Absolutely, a fantastic match for us. We have Denmark against Taiwan. We were talking briefly about how Sun is actually the friend of the actual world champion for TCG. And they are playing today, card by card, the same deck list, and they are both in the finals for their category. That's just unreal to me.
I can't believe it. Both the decks, both the players here just worked so hard to make it all the way here to the finals of the Dragon Duel World Championship 2019.
And it's interesting, the field for each tournament shaped up basically the same, but not really the way I would have expected to at the start of the weekend. What we found was that Salamangreat was the most popular deck when... I was thinking, you know, maybe a little more of the Crusadia Thunder Dragon kind.
Absolutely. And even though we saw otherwise quite wide the format with a lot of different decks, especially in the Dragon Duelist, in the end, both finals ended up being a Salamangreat mirror match, which is very interesting. And I think we were talking with Billy on stream multiple times that the approach that Sun in particular had is very good. He built his deck to beat the mirror match. He is now against the mirror match in the final, so I think he's very close to actually becoming world champion for Taiwan. So
it's very exciting. I can't wait to see what these players are going to play. I hope it's an amazing game, like some of the amazing matches we got to watch all weekend long here this weekend in Berlin.
Our duelists have their headphones on. They're going to start shuffling up. We will be able to get underway shortly. But thoughts on this particular matchup between the two? Like, what are the keys to this particular deck matchup?
So it is definitely quite a back and forth one. As I was saying, I gotta say that at least in game one, Taiwan has the advantage, just because of how it is shaped up. It has very a lot of touches for the mirror match. He has mind control in the main deck, which is something that when we saw him in action, by the way, we saw both of these guys already on stream, he dominated. Every time he drew the card, he was always winning the game on the spot. So I'm very curious to see if this is going to happen again for Sun.
That's one of those things that you can do in a small tournament like this, where you have a very good idea of what's going on. If you suspect that the matchups are going to be a certain way, and there's a certain card that you would normally side deck, you might consider bringing it into your main deck.
Which we've definitely seen here this weekend, and that is why both the players with using the exact same identical deck list have made the finals of each different category of the World Championship.
Yeah, and honestly, it doesn't get more hyped than this. We are at a huge venue with an incredible crowd watching live, so you can hear a lot of friends, a lot of applause is going on. And if it is tough for the TCG and, let's say, the older guys, you got to give credits to these two players. They proved on stream multiple times that they can hold their nerves and play just as good as the TCG champions, we can say. So I'm definitely excited to see if they are going to keep their nerves. I would bet on it, if I'm honest. So I think we are in for a very good treat here.
It's a tough one. The finals in anything, that last one is always the hardest one. So, you know, the duelist who is able to keep his calm, play his cards right, will walk away the winner today. So our players are now shuffling each other's decks. We've got to ensure proper randomization.
Yes. Also important to mention, we had a lot of different rules throughout the event. Of course, it is the most competitive tournament of the year. And for the final, we're going to have 60 minutes compared to what we had in the previous round. So it was 40 minutes for the Swiss rounds and the top eight. It was 50 minutes for the top four. And now finally 60 minutes. So we're going to enjoy possibly quite a long match, quite a back and forth one, we hope. And if in game one Sun might have an advantage, things are going to completely turn around in the side decks, and we are going to have, I think, some really exciting action from both of these guys.
Now, if you haven't kept up with the World Championship action this weekend, you might be a little confused as to what those extra cards are on the field. Those are randomization indicators. They're there to let the duelists know whether or not the deck has been properly shuffled and whether or not they are allowed to draw a card for it. So if you see those flipping back and forth throughout the duel, don't worry. It's not some new gameplay element that we're springing on anyone at the last moment. It's just a way to make sure that our duelists are ready to go.
Also, yeah, it is definitely up there, and even if one of these guys is not going to be crowned world champion, they can still try. So it is important to say that in the last years we had some champions from the Dragon Duel section actually advance to the TCG because of their age.
Indeed.
I don't think it is going to be the case for this year, which means that the defending champion can actually come back and try to keep his title, while the other guy can also try and qualify again, and maybe we can have the same finals next year, possibly. That could be quite the avenging story, and you know about avenging finals, Billy.
Sometimes you got to play the same guy in the finals multiple times, and yeah. Sometimes you win, sometimes you lose.
All right.
You did have the die roll already, I believe.
And it looks like our duelists are shuffled up and ready to go as well. And we also have received word that the finals are going to be untimed.
Yes.
So untimed finals, we will go until there is a winner. Best of three.
It all comes down to this. One more duel, one more match, and then we'll be crowning the new Dragon Duel World Champion 2019.
Our Dragon Duelists are getting in the zone right now. Waiting for the signal to begin.
Yep. Sun did win the die roll, so that's huge in the Salaman Great Mirror match. He's going to be probably choosing to go first, I can imagine, especially with the certain card choices that he has in his deck here this week.
Yeah, it will be surely impactful, but with these particular deck building choices, I don't think it is going to be too important, so we are probably going to see quite a back and forth, even in game one, where he has an advantage. We said about his cards, he's also playing DD Crow, which is quite an old one that has not really seen popularity, but
one of my favorite hand traps of all time.
Absolutely, and he has been having a lot of advantage with it throughout the fields. I don't believe they played each other yet, but they had the chance to even watch them compete. And for anyone, you can just go back and watch the action we had yesterday. We had a lot of good matches. So those guys definitely had a look and know that they are up against a tough opponent who knows what they're doing, who knows that they're playing the same deck, so they definitely are going to know what's happening in the other side of the field. And
Now, you two have played all sorts of championship events, and you mentioned something interesting about not playing each other during the Swiss. Have you ever had a case where you did play against somebody in Swiss and lose to them, and then come back in the playoffs and beat them?
Yes, that happened with me and Joshua Schmidt, actually, before.
Oh, one of our world championship competitors.
Yep, multiple times. Yeah, he's played in four world championships, one of my favorite players of all times. Shout out to Joshua.
Yeah, and it does happen from time to time. I had one of the redemption stories as well at one of the European Championships where I only lost to two particular players in the Swiss, and then in top 32 and 16, I actually beat them throughout my...
So you doubled up on it.
Yeah, I doubled up on it, and it does happen. That's always a really good feeling. And I think overall what we were talking about, and what I think especially these very young players, and also the one who didn't make it into the finals, but still huge props to you for being here at the World Championship, is you always learn more from your losses than from your wins. So for everyone competing, you have lost, you didn't make it to the finals, but it was still an incredible experience. Use all the knowledge you had from this event and make it for the next ones.
Yeah, it's definitely the hardest tournament to be able to compete in every year, and just making it is a huge achievement for sure.
Absolutely.
It looks like we're still waiting for the duels to get ready.
We're getting some final instructions here.
Yeah, of course, they're going to explain the rules. They're going to explain that there is no time limit, which does play a huge role. And to be honest, I think it is quite a correct decision because we are going to get to just play even with a little bit less tension, I feel, which is probably going to be still skyrocketing because it doesn't get more serious than this. But it is good that they don't have to pay too much attention to their speed, I guess. So
yeah, for sure. They get to take their time to think about their plays. I mean, you still have to play at a pace.
A reasonable pace, but...
But I think it's like, you don't have to like the pressure. Yeah, exactly what you were saying.
Yeah.
And our duelists will both have access to the card database as well, up at the table. Since this is a multinational tournament, you're going to be seeing cards in a lot of different languages. Maybe they have different foil treatments. A lot of them are going to look very cool. But sometimes you just need to know the exact text of a specific card, and for this event, each player is provided with the ability to go into the card database and see the card effects in their language of choice.
I do think the duelists are finally almost ready to get the finals of the Dragon Duel World Championship 2019 underway.
I'm having a hard time staying in my seat.
Yes. I'm very
excited for this.
One last match, these two guys. Who is going to be crowned the world champion? We're going to find out quite soon.
Here we are. For the World Championship 2019 Dragon Duelists. They've come a long way. Give them a round of applause for some support, please. There we go. All right, duelists, it's time to duel. Good luck.
All right, here we go.
Both the players have drawn their opening hands. And Sun did win the die roll, so I have to assume he is going to be the one going first.
Most likely, yeah. It is pretty fine to assume that they know what each other is playing, so he opens quite a good end. So you can see the circle and the spinny, which is usually enough to just push through. And at the moment, there are no entraps in Vidus' end. He does have the Phantasme, so that will be important to try and look for one, because otherwise we are going to see a very good opening from Sun, possibly ending into Abyss Dweller, since he knows what the matchup is. And that card is just phenomenal in this matchup.
Yeah, we've seen it come up a lot this weekend.
Absolutely. It's just almost a dimensional barrier for the deck, we were saying. You can still push through, but it is very hard. And when you pair it up with some traps, in this case, it gets tough. So these two draws from Vidus are probably among the most important in his entire Yu-Gi-Oh! Career. So,
Phantasme summons itself from hand, lets you draw cards equal to the number of link monsters your opponent controls plus one, and then shuffle back equal to the number of link monsters they control.
Very good in the Salaman Great Mirror. We've seen it come down a lot, you know, fixing your hands, trying to dig to those hand traps, and just having that body on the board has actually been huge this weekend.
And unfortunately, he does pick up one of his many entraps, but it is the only real entrap, which is the Impermanence that doesn't really have a synergy with the Phantasme. So right now, Sun is basically free to do whatever he wants. And I think he's just going to try and play around things, but once he realized that there is no response from Vidus, he is just going to go wild here.
See the Gazelle coming down, going to send down the Salaman Great Trap to the graveyard and activate the effect of Spinny to special summon it back to the field.
And here you can see one of the silver lining, you can say, about Sun and Chai deck, which is the same. Since they're playing part of the Zarya, they decided to play multiple copies of cards that you usually see at one, both Trap cards and Jaguar. And that means that, like in this case, when you open them, it makes your combo also better. So in this case, you will be able to end on Abyss Dweller, Roar, and Rage, which is basically just the best opening for Salaman Great possible, I'd say.
Yeah, most definitely.
Trap cards have been one of the big things for Salaman Great this weekend. An increase in the number of like actual trap cards, in more copies of Roar, more copies of Rage, Solemns and Permanences, all that kind of stuff has really factored into the success of Salaman Great in this tournament.
Yeah, I think lately the World Championship is being polarized by this kind of back and forth and control decks. We saw last year an incredible final, at least in the TCG, where it was Altergeist against Trickster, and it was just like so old-fashioned. In Game 3, you saw Cyber Dragon against Thunder King Ryo in 2018, which is just unbelievable.
Yeah, that was crazy last
year.
It's
more like 2008.
Yeah, exactly. So now, basically, by using Abyss Stallio to bounce back the Phantasme, he actually made the Impermanence live, which is a pretty cool thing, but it was kind of too late, I would say, because it didn't really have an impact on the game.
Yeah, he still was able to get to the Abyss Dweller, which is the
But at least he negated the Wolf from getting back the Rage, which is a good plus there. So yeah.
Rage so strong with its ability to take out multiple cards if you have a Link monster that was Link summoned using another monster of the same name. Colloquially, it's called Reincarnation Link Summoning from the anime series, Soul Burner's Technique from Vrains.
Using that Sanctuary. So Circle coming down here, he'll search his deck for any Salaman Great.
Yes, he picks up another Foxy, which isn't the greatest. Of course, you want to have a few engine cards, but not too many, but he does have a pretty good hand. You will just try and see what the unknown back row is. We do know from our vision that it is the counter trap, so you will need to be playing around that.
And he's got to do it without effects in the graveyard as well, thanks to Abyss Dweller.
Exactly.
So you see the normal summon of Salaman Great Foxy. See if he decides to use the effect to excavate the top three cards.
It wouldn't seem like you do. Yeah. But let's see what he's going to pick up.
No, he did. He did use it.
Yeah.
Debug, Effect Veiler, and
Spinny. It does pick up Spinny. You already had a copy, so not too relevant again, but a good addition. And For everyone watching both here at the live stage and home, just as a reminder, there are a few differences if you're playing for the TCG in how the rulings for this event are, because of course we have to put everyone in the same spot, let's say, and there are a few differences in the rulings. The main one being that the effects of cards like the foul we're seeing on screen have to be chained as and considered as quick effects. So you have to give your opponent the chance to respond to your cards before you can chain your own foul, gazelle, and phantasmi, for example. So it does play a huge role in some of the situations, and this is what might have happened here.
Yep. So it looks like he's putting the spinning back, and they're fixing the situation.
Yeah, I think it is possible that by the body language, I assumed, as you were saying, that he didn't use the Foxy, really, which seemed the case. So maybe that's what's going on. He, of course, needed to use the Foxy as Chen Lingquan.
He intended to use it.
Yeah. If he didn't, then you cannot really manipulate the Chen Links otherwise.
So communication key, especially when you're trying to use maneuvers that you complex chain kind of things.
Yeah. And what happened actually was that, as you can see, there are two little cards, a red one and a green one. That is because also the shuffling rules were a little different this time. If you see a red card, it means that the deck is not randomized. It will need to be shuffled and then cut by your opponent. And since he resolved the circle and he didn't turn the card into green, he activated the Foxy before the deck was actually randomized. So they had to shuffle it back before the effect resolved.
Okay, so that makes sense.
Yeah.
But we saw when he used the Foxy effect the second time, missed completely, no Salamanger cards to be added to his hand.
Unfortunate, but the first one wasn't too impactful, to be honest, so.
So he's got the foul effect freezing down the back row card. That sends foul to the graveyard and lets Spinny come down from the hand as well.
See where he goes from here.
Salamangreat Gazelle can special summon itself from the hand when your Salamangreat card goes to the graveyard. And when it's summoned, you get to send the Salamangreat card from your deck to the graveyard.
It's a pretty good one.
It is. It's quite crucial to almost everything that Salamangreat deck does. So you want to get to it as fast as you can. Send Salamangreat Roar to the graveyard.
It's always polite to ask your opponent before you check the graveyard. I'm a big fan of that. See an overlay coming down here from Rosh Dahlia.
Rosh Dahlia has quite a beefy attack. 2,000. Its effect also lets you summon a Salamangreat from your deck.
And now we're basically in a similar situation. The Abyss Dweller is playing like a huge key in this game, but just like Vitus didn't have any real responses, now Soon is relying on this Phantasma in hand. And right now, he is not able to summon it anytime soon. So as soon as Vitus is going to commit to a Link Summon, then we're going to see it come down.
It'll be helpful there with its anti-targeting ability in this case.
Exactly. Especially against the popular Mind Control that we're seeing in a lot of the finalist deck lists.
Oh, interesting. Vitus took a look at the game situation there and decided that he was unable to win this one. So you see the card there with the white flag on there. That means exactly what you think it is.
Yeah.
It's a concession or surrender for the current duel.
So that's game one. Just like that, Sun is up one. He's only one game away now from making it, becoming the world champion, the Dragon Duel world champion.
That's a great position for him as well. If you can go up one duel with the kind of build that he has, you have a very good shot of taking that second one as well.
Absolutely. He was the favorite walking into this game, as we were saying. Game one, I mean, most of the times I would say it will go in his favor, because regardless of winning the die roll, he has so many cards that are good against the mirror match that it wasn't a surprise. But without a time limit, I am a little bit surprised that Vitus didn't just try and continue, because you see this from a lot of competitive players where they know how to handle the timer very well. Mm-hmm. So they do know where they are in a position of just, I'm done with this game, let's just save some time for the next ones. But in this one, I feel like he could have just tried a little bit more. But the Abyss Dweller, we just say how it is so annoying to deal with here, so he probably just fought. He wasn't going anywhere, and
it may be a case where he committed to a line of play that would involve the Mirage Dahlia's graveyard effect.
Exactly.
And then realized, oh wait, Abyss Dweller resolved this turn. This line of play isn't going to work, and I'm not going to get another turn.
Yeah, it is definitely an option, but now we commented on the main decks. The side decks are quite different, and I feel like now Vitus is going to have more of a fair time, because he does have his own copies of very popular side deck cards in the mirror match, like the DD Crows and Super Polymerizations that we're going to see in both of these players' main decks. So I think now it gets definitely more fair, and it's going to be interesting to see this, because when you have an edge in deck building, mm-hmm. I feel that's probably the biggest edge you can have in the game in general, if you agree with me, Billy.
Oh, definitely.
I think that's absolutely right.
Yeah, but then it gets interesting when you're facing, after siding especially, a deck that pretty much has the same cards and touches as you. Then it gets probably more to how you draw, and now you're actually piloting your deck. So it gets to technical play some of the times, and when you're nervous, I think technical play is really where you see the difference between a professional player, you can say, and someone who is not used to being in such a stage often.
Practice is really a key thing for this.
It is.
Like, you just want to duel as much as you can, just to figure out, you know, how your deck works, how the various other decks works.
You see the more
just
scenarios.
Just to see as many scenarios as you possibly can. Because sometimes you'll just, like, you'll know what your deck is supposed to do, but what happens when it's not doing what it's supposed to do?
Yep, that separates the men from the boys.
So we can look back to, like, round one of the Dragon Duel yesterday, where, you know, in duel three of that match, both players' decks didn't really do what they were supposed to do, and it turned into, you know, just a brawl between monsters.
Exactly, yeah.
And you got to know how to win those games as well.
Yeah, this is something we were actually talking about with Billy through one round and the other. It is that we get questioned a lot on, like, how to improve and how to get better, but the truth is that there are no real shortcuts in general. Like, playing as much as possible is just the best thing you can do. And if you enjoy the game, that's also, like, one fun way to do it. You meet friends and you get better at the game, because that's the only real way to do it.
Yeah, so if you're not having fun, what are you doing?
Yeah, it doesn't even exactly feel like practice at that point if you're just having a good time.
Exactly. All right. Looks like game two is almost underway. There's finishing the shuffle.
Yep, they've got to do the cuts first. It is shuffle, shuffle, cut, cut.
And here we go, drawing the hands. Game two underway.
Okay, so we are seeing the ends, and even though there is a Sanctuary in Soon End, which is never something you want to draw, a Phantasme is there to fix it, so that's the best feeling ever, since you can draw two new fresh cards and just shuffle back the Sanctuary.
Yeah, you basically get the two free cards, you're saying, because you put the Sanctuary back,
exactly,
and then you add it back, so it's like you get an extra card from that Phantasme.
Yeah,
Vetus is supposedly going first, yeah. And this Foxy is going to be crucial. Can he pick up anything here?
It's got Buffalo.
Oh, that's not what he was looking for. You already had the Rage. He was really looking for anything, really, a Spinny, a Circle, or a Gazelle.
Mm-hmm.
And now it doesn't seem like his end is that good. So he's going to be forced to go into a Baylinx, which is going to be met by a Phantasmite. And, yeah, it's going to be tough.
Yeah, this is definitely going to be a rough game here.
Yeah, it is reminding me a little bit of the very unfortunate top four with Hangel.
Oh, yeah.
Shoutouts to him. He made it all the way to top four. But then, unfortunately, he lost because he didn't really get things going in either of the games against the current world champion. So
it probably drew the worst hands we've seen here this weekend.
Yeah, this is, doesn't really rely to that, because he at least has a few of the Solomon Great Monsters. And he's still going to set up Roar plus Rage with a few Entraps to back those up. So it is going to be
certainly has a chance.
Interesting one.
And he does have another Salamangreat in his hand. So, you know, if he gets around to the next turn, he certainly has some things he can do.
Absolutely. And in Soon End, you basically see a lot of side deck cards at the moment. Evenly matched, one of the least convincing one for me. I was never a fan of it against Salamangreat. And you can see it conflicting here with Phantasma as well.
Mm-hmm.
So
that one's just going to get negated
but
a lot.
But the freshly drawn one, it is a convincing one.
Oh,
it is the lone copy of Super Polymerization. That's very surprising. They decided to side only one, but It is there, and
seeing the mind control come down, how good it is in the mirror match. Yeah, just forcing out the roar.
Oh, and he's got Jack Jaguar as well. Always a key part of Salaman Great, you know, not just mirror matches, but any match you have with Salaman Great.
Absolutely.
That's the key card that keeps your cards recycling, keeps itself coming back to the field, keeps triggering Sunlight Wolf's ability.
Yeah, we see it and draw it so often because they did choose to play multiple copies here this weekend.
So, it's really important.
It is, and here I'm very interested in seeing, in the match I was referring about before, so the Hangul one, the Korean World Champion, which we repeated is a friend of Soon with the same deck, witnessed a very similar situation, and he completely avoided going into Link Summons to play around a possible Phantasmi from his opponent. I want to see if this is going to be the same case. Honestly, you can argue the situation is very similar, but... let's see if he thinks he can afford to do that.
So Salaman Great Rage takes out Phantasme, using its second ability that targets your own monster, not your opponent's. And then Jack Jaguar is used to make Salaman Great Balinx for Sun.
Yeah.
And he gets to search the sanctuary that he put back with the Phantasme.
And yeah, younger are usually braver, so he does go into Link Summons, and we'll see if that will pay off differently from his friend. Something important to remind, obviously, is the importance of Ita in the mirror match. It is a Link Chu that completely, I think, revolutionized the way the mirror match is being played. You have to avoid at all times to put powerful fire monsters in your graveyard, and it is always something to pay attention to.
For sure. See, Link Summon for Sunlight Wolf.
Going to bring back that Jack Jaguar to the zone that Sunlight Wolf is pointing to.
Link it away for a Balinx. Trigger Sunlight Wolf effect.
And he gets back there. Takes the Jack Jaguar.
Yeah, he needs cards to be discarded from the Super Pony immunization, so why not? And the Diddy Crow is one of the crucial cards he has in his main deck. So you would think that Diddy Crow and Mind Controls were cards that he sided for this matchup. No, he's actually maining them, which you can see is why he is being so successful in a field full of Salaman Great decks. This could have honestly been game one for how his deck is structured outside of the evenly match, really. So.
Yeah, I see what you mean about the evenly matched, how not so good in the mirror match. Like, it can be a way to break through stuff, but when you have cards like Mind Control, it can force out the roar and stuff.
And I feel like it conflicts not only with the Phantasmi, but like with the other Entropes. Mm-hmm. If you're really slowing them down, like with Diddy Crow and the other Entropes, then they're not going to overextend that much. But now a Flame Buffalo is picked up by Vitus. He really needs these two new cards because he doesn't have much going on at all right now, so... that's going to be important. He also has the option to go into a Phoenix if he wants, co-linking it in front of his opponent Sunlight Wolf to get even an extra draw. So we'll see how he decides to go for this.
It also clears out his extra monster zone as well, so he has access to that too.
Looks like he decides to go into the Sunlight Wolf instead. The Phoenix is right there on top of his extra. Maybe that was coming down.
It is, but one thing you got to worry about is Sunlight Wolf's ability. When something summoned to a zone, it points to, and it does point towards your opponent.
Mm-hmm.
So you could inadvertently trigger its ability yourself.
So it does pick up the Sign and Mining, so that's what one of the cards he was looking for. He was missing his core pieces, let's say, so he's going to be able to get either two Gazelle or whatever he feels like it's good. He could also be getting a Spinny, for example, since he has the Foxy Engrave. He can discard the Spinny, bring back the Foxy, and then try and force out some negations while making the Stallio. So we'll see how he decides to go for this.
Signet Mining gives you any level 4 or lower Cybers monster.
Yeah.
So it's just something to think about if you're playing any of the many Cybers decks.
Okay, so he does go for the line that I was suggesting, and unfortunately we know that the Diddy Crow is going to be there, and that's not going to be pleasant for him.
That's huge.
Here, there are a few options. I would say one of them could be just going for a double Eat Leo to try and push through, but definitely tough to realize the situation in which you're in. At least the Eat Leo is really good because it overcomes the problem of Balinx protecting the will, while putting it back into the deck just solves the problem.
It's going to be tough to deal with the super polymerization that he has face down.
Oh, yeah. Of course.
Yeah, you'd also like to see one fewer back row card here. I'm a lot less comfortable making an aggressive play into two than one. Especially, you know Solomon Great Decks have two trap cards that can get you. Plus any number of side deck cards.
Okay, so here the spin is going to be activated, and just like Billy was saying, there is an option that we're just going to see a super polymerization being flipped up here, which would be terrible for Vitus. Let's see what Soon decides to do. You got to consider it, because if it Leo comes down, then it is not as good of an option, and I think that's what we are going to see.
All right, so we've got Heat Meal number one that can activate its ability to get rid of a spell or trap card.
This is why I really didn't like the weight.
The super poly.
I mean, it is close, but like if the super poly was targeted there, you are gonna lose your Sunlight Wolf, honestly, unnecessarily. And he took the risk, and just like he took the risk with the bailing. So as we were saying, it seems like not only is calm and not nervous, but he also has quite the courage to go for these plays,
which are a bit of damage as well.
Yep.
Then in the end phase, we see the super polymerization,
bring out the Violet Chimera,
and that leaves him with an empty field.
That's.
Other than one trap card back there, which is, we know it's a Salamangreat Roar, which he can't play. So if Sun can get 6,700 on the board right here, he will be the world champion.
Definitely a surprise using the Super Poly in the end phase. He knew that the face down card from Vitus is the Roar that he got back with the Wolf, so he wanted to shut down that, but it wasn't like it was possible to use it because you cannot chain to super polymerization, of course. So I feel like you could have waited the...
See what he draws.
Yeah, especially because you do lose the attack boost from the Violet Chimera because it only lasts until the end phase.
Still, base stats, not bad.
Absolutely. So he picks up his own Roar, which is also quite a nice.
Just doing some math, adding up what he can do, how much...
Yeah, but it doesn't seem like he can push too much damage right here, especially with the double effect Veiler in Vitus' hand.
Yes, and he doesn't have an available zone to summon from his extra deck too, unless he uses the Violet Chimera as one of the materials.
So it seems like he got a little bit ahead of himself. The thing is, the Roar, just like many negation cards in Yu-Gi-Oh, it does prevent the activation of a spell and trap, but it doesn't negate the effect of a spell and trap, so he couldn't negate the on-field will, which is also a very relevant thing that would have allowed him to push a lot more damage there.
Will of the Salamangreat, very strong card that gives you at least one extra summon each turn, and you can cash it in for more than that if you have a reincarnated Salamangreat Limp Monster. And he goes for his own Heat Leo.
Yeah, so this is the Heat Leo comes down, targeting the Roar. Vitus is going to think about it because his own Roar isn't that impactful right now, but he decides to go for the Effect Veiler. So
he's going to put back the Violet Chimera, just put some of the Jack Jaguar, activate Salamangreat Sanctuary.
Very relevant to put it back because he is also playing Fusion of Fire, so he has the possibility to actually summon a second Violet Chimera later on in the duel. Now the draw for Vitus is going to be extremely important. He really needs to pick up something that he can discard with the Buffalo, and unfortunately with the Roar being the last card from Soon, it is going
to
be tough. Ooh!
Except the Roar just came back.
Oh, the handshake.
Oh my goodness.
Soon just wins. 2-0, handshakes. He drew the card that he shuffled right here, and I think Soon is going to be declared our new world champion.
That is just unlucky for Vitus.
Just checking on the head judge confirmation, because you have to ask if you are allowed to concede, but there is nothing he can do at the moment, so...
Yep, there we go, and that's the concession.
Comes down, and we have our first world champion of the day.
Congratulations. Taiwan showing that they are a force to be reckoned with.
They really are.
Absolutely. They are the current world champion for the TCG Taiwan. And here, again, one more world champion and one more world champion that is a friend of the current TCG world champion. Ooh, by the way, we will see later today. So maybe today we will crown not one, but two Taiwanese world champions for Yu-Gi-Oh! So
using the same exact deck list.
That's card for crazy.
Card. It really is amazing. So at least for now, I mean, he's still the world champion until someone beats him, right? So at least for now, we have two. But that was really a textbook match. Like, Sun Chang-Yan played extraordinarily well in that one, and he got the job done very quickly. And that's another thing, is that if you can finish your match, you know, as quickly as you can, like, that's part of why you go for some of those aggressive moves sometimes, just to deny your opponent the extra draw phases that might get them to something that could get them back in the
Absolutely.
Game.
To be honest, we were talking about it both during the introduction to the finals and before the match, and we knew, or at least we were talking about how he had an edge in this matchup, but honestly, I didn't think it would just go this quick. He completely... I think Vitus really never stood a chance in this particular match. You still gotta give a credit to him and congratulations to how he represented Denmark, which is also a country that you don't often see at this stage. So very a good job on Vitus. I'm sure he has a lot of talent and a lot of options to redeem himself later on the next year. But now it is a soon day. Everyone should crown him. So. He's the new champion. Congratulations a lot to him. I think he's now going to sit along with our crowd. And
yep.
Yeah.
Congratulations. Congratulations. World champion. Fantastic. So wonderful. How are you feeling? How's the feeling?
感谢家人还有那些陪我练牌的人。
So he would like to thank for his family and those who practice with him.
Okay. And do you have any words of encouragement for everyone else who you competed with? Very good. Well, congratulations. Thanks again. Shin Chang-en, well done. Hey, don't forget your trophy. He's so modest. And just so you know, we're going to take a short 10-minute break to set up for the next event. Thank you very much. Stay tuned. No problem, no problem. No, he was...
All right, so coming up next is going to be the Duel Links Finals. So that's going to take a little bit for us to set up. We got to get all the machines on stage. Everybody's using kind of their own specialized machine provided for them. Just make sure everything's on the up and up and everything is taken care of very well. So that's being set up right now. And while we are in a holding pattern there, you know, we could tell you a little bit about some of the cool stuff that's been going on at the World Championship this weekend. And maybe we could talk a little bit about, you know, what the World Championship experience is like from a player's perspective. Like, what did you get to do? What was fun when your World Championship?
It's nerve-wracking. Nerve-wracking is the best way I can describe it. It's a lot of pressure. Just the whole time, like, you're just worried. Like, you're constantly worried about what's going to happen. Who am I going to play against? What is everyone else using? Did I prepare my deck enough? Is everything ready? Like,
so when does the anxiety start? Like, which day? Is it the day you arrive?
I think it's the entire every day leading up to it, and then it just the every day up until like that round one starts. And then after you play your first round, you get a little bit of pressure off. You get a little more relaxed and a little more used to playing. And that's such, and I've played in more probably high level tournaments than anybody in the world, and none of it compared to playing in the World Championship.
Yeah, exactly. Both of us have been playing for probably more than 10 years or close to that, and in my opinion, that's the same. Like, we have both won tournaments, and nothing really come close to what I was feeling at the World Championship. Mm-hmm. It was by far the most incredible experience I had related to the game. First of all, for us, it was Tokyo, Japan, so yes. We got to see a lot there. Yes. The tour was fantastic. You're hanging out at least in our case, with a lot of our friends. So it was the first time that the World Championship point and leaderboard was introduced. Mm-hmm. So it was a very interesting concept for us. And I think it made a lot of the people that are really grinding throughout the year and going to all events more inclined to qualify for the World Championship. Mm-hmm. And it was just the best experience ever. So
it really was.
Yeah, we got to see a lot. We got to see the local shops. We got to see, of course, and the food and everything that comes up with it. But then, as you were saying, the tournament itself is just unique. You don't ever get 30 or less people tournaments in competitive Yu-Gi-Oh! Usually it's more of 1,000, 2,000, even more players. So having to actually play every round against the best players in the world doesn't really come close to anything else like that.
And yeah. You mentioned it. We do send you on some pretty nice stuff when you come out to the championship. So we fly you out here to wherever it is, and you do get to go on a tour of whatever the city is. And you know, one of the reasons we hold YCS is that sort of thing all over the place, that there's so many wonderful places in the world that are really worth visiting. And they're just places that duelists flock to. So we want to make sure that everybody gets a chance to, you know, see the world when they come to the World Championship.
Yeah, exactly.
That's a lot of fun.
Throughout my dueling career, I've traveled all over the world. I've won in 3 different countries. I've played in 5 or 6 different countries. I've been everywhere but Australia. I'll have to go one day.
Yeah, same then.
But yeah, Yu-Gi-Oh's done so much for me. It's fantastic. Mm-hmm. All the things you get to see, the people you get to meet, the friends you make along the way.
Yeah, it definitely changed our life. It's undeniable. And it was especially the World Championship on its own experience that I would suggest anyone will really try their best to have, because it's just unique and it really touches your soul, I'd say.
It really does.
Now, even if you aren't a World Championship competitor, you know, you could still come and check out the festivities, as you know, 1,000 people behind us are doing right now. And while you're at the World Championship, oftentimes there's a lot of cool stuff that you can get to bring back home as well. And we got some of that behind here. Let me show you what we got.
Yes.
So we've got, we saw Kaiba dueling a little earlier, and you have this nice Figma figure of Kaiba. We've got his briefcase, dual disc, all sorts of cool stuff.
That's so cool.
So you can set him up on your desk or wherever, and have him duel, you know, your chair whenever you're not around. Yeah.
And we there have some mugs as well. In this case,
I mean, this one's one of my favorites.
You activated my trap car mugs, which is just so fun. And we'll probably just try and get some coffee out of this one later on. It's
I'm a big tea drinker, so like I gotta have a mug with me. I think I have 2 right now, but you know, 3 or 4, it's fine. I'll just pick whichever one's my favorite for the day.
But of course, we do have also our players' favorite, the same sleeves that our World Championship participants are using, a beautiful mat, and some participation cards.
Sort of well.
And you get that just for showing up
as well.
Oh, the mat's beautiful.
So the players obviously get to use these sort of deck boxes. They're very nice looking, but you can get them as well when you come out to the World Championship.
And you can see this beautiful mat as well.
I think these are
which
the
is from the prize car from last year's winners. So it is a really unique event. And as you guys probably know, throughout even the next week in Europe and right now in the USA, we have the World Celebration events as well.
Yes.
Which is always great. You get to have a taste of what it feels like to compete at the World Championship. You usually use the same Forbidden and Limited list that these players are using, and you do get to get some promos as well for this year. It's Monster Reborn and Red Eyes. So it's a very cool event, and I suggest you guys to check your local OTS stores and wherever they are hosting it, just and try and go to these very cool events. So
come to think of it, some places might be doing them right now.
Yeah, exactly.
You might be watching a set of World Championship celebrations.
That's true.
And if you are, we hope you're having a great time. Thanks for tuning in.
Good luck in your tournament that you're playing in currently.
Yep.
Yes.
So we've also had recently in Los Angeles, there was an art exhibition. So like art based on Yu-Gi-Oh! And
I saw that.
Yu-Gi-Oh!
I saw pictures from
has
that.
Has been really popular as of late. And I went to that gallery and it was fantastic. You know, we got some prints for it. You know, we do YouTube videos back in the office. We have a little studio set up.
Yeah.
It's got art now. It's fantastic. But we also have some art here that people who come to the World Championship can take home with them. And I believe we got that right behind you, Marco.
Yes, absolutely.
Is that a Dark Side of Dimensions kind of
one of the piece of art we can show you?
What do you got there? Oh, it's for the Dark
Side.
It is for the Dark Side.
Dark Side of Dimensions. So
that is cool.
This is also one of the frames that's available here for everyone who is come as a spectator. So it is really some sort of unique amount of art, and it's something that has never been done before for the game. So I think it's very refreshing, and if it is such an impactful thing in our life, you should definitely have something on your house. It's one of the very cool things you can do. So
you usually wear the duelist tag proudly.
Exactly. Yeah.
I always have. Always will.
Yeah.
And also, I feel kind of a sinister power behind me. You have a spirit of an ancient Egyptian pharaoh back there? I think yes. I was possessed for a while earlier today.
Oh, yeah. The live duel was fantastic.
We got him out now. Yeah. He's back.
I really enjoyed the live duel that we got to see. Hopefully you guys also enjoyed it as much as I did.
Oh, so we also got, speaking of pharaoh, we have this Nendoroid here, which I don't think is available in Europe yet. So duels who are here...
Jealous.
...are here right now at the World Championship will have an early shot at getting the Yami Yugi Nendo here.
Oh, yeah, that looks awesome.
I mean, he's trying to look menacing, but it's a little cute. Anyways, that's kind of how the Nendos work in general. They're really nice. I have a few things from this line on my desk at work, actually. They're really, really nice.
That's cool. Yep, a lot of cool stuff here, a lot of cool stuff to do, whether you're playing at Worlds or just here as an attendee. Get to check out the action, get to see some of the best players in the world.
Absolutely, and at the end of the day, this represents the end of the season of competitive Yu-Gi-Oh! And these guys to get here had to compete at a lot of different events, and from September on, we are going to be back with the new competitive season as well. So the new prize card for YCS was announced. We're going to have a lot of new events. We were talking about how exciting it is that we get even different events. We're going to have a YCS in Lima in November 3rd, which is going to be 3v3, and also in Las Vegas later on in February in 2012. So I think those kind of events are unique. You were telling me about how in Atlanta, yeah, it was such a fantastic experience, right?
I was going to say, we have our 3v3 team right here.
Oh, so yeah.
I mean, all duels welcome.
I think we can take anyone, actually.
Who's going to take us down? Yeah. We're waiting, so.
The 3v3 was a blast, though. Like,
yeah.
Every player that talked to one of our people at the event was just like, this is great. You need to do this more.
Yeah, the
and
atmosphere.
I'm glad that we are.
Yeah, because you get to sit there and play with your friends. Like, you not only hang out with your friends in between rounds, because that is actually my favorite part of the tournament, is the in between rounds.
Yeah,
you're sitting around.
Do it in between rounds. You can do it the
whole time.
Yeah,
exactly. Just sitting around, hanging out with your friends, talking, letting them know your bad beat story. Exactly. Yeah, that's everyone comes up. Oh man, I lost. I got so unlucky. Oh, true. I know, man. Yeah. It's a lot of fun just hanging out with friends. Like, having fun is the most important part about the game. That's what I always tell everyone. Like, how do you win? How do you do well? I have fun.
Yeah, if you're not enjoying yourself, you're not gonna win. You can't just. I mean, that's why Kaiba never wins. Really, he's just here to destroy.
The show tells you so many things. So many good ideas. Yeah, but the live duel was a lot of fun. It was very long, and
that
I really enjoyed it.
And a lot of those cards there that you might not have seen before, you will see in a couple weeks. Those are promo cards that you'll find in the gold sarcophagus tins.
Which is
so
awesome.
Exodia, the Legendary Defender, Magician of Black Chaos Max, Blue Eyes Alternative Ultimate Dragon, Neo Kaiser Glider. All of those cards are, you know, possible cards you can get in the tin. You get two of them in each out of a pool of six. Palladium Oracle Mana is one of them.
Very cool, like really good cards. Yeah, I love the Magician Chaos Max. That's
Chaos
so
Max?
Cool.
Yeah,
I really like Mana. Just keep popping out of the graveyard, protecting your monsters, special summoning things. It's just a get a lot of cards out of that one. I'm looking forward. Actually, I gotta rebuild my Dark Magician deck.
Yeah, absolutely. Gotta keep it up to date. And
it'll be a couple weeks though. I gotta get the 10 cards first.
Absolutely. Yeah, gotta collect them, and then. It's going to be possible. And
I like the tin itself. I've always wanted a gold sarcophagus, and the table just get it. I have as many as I want now.
Yep, there you go. You just build a wall of gold sarcophagi.
That's so cool.
Fortress out of them. That'd be cool.
I've been really happy with a lot of the products that have been coming out recently. A lot of cool, different things that we haven't seen in a long time.
So in terms of organized play, you know, we got the UDS coming up. We got a YCS coming up.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And then we got regionals starting as well.
The brand new season about to be underway.
I'm so excited.
Yeah, brand new season. If you guys thought this was over, it's just like we're going to take a couple of days after this event, but then it's all from big beginning. So new season, new tournaments, locals. So you have a lot to do. You never really stop playing Yu-Gi-Oh, I'd say. And it is always enjoyable. And just think about what you want to do. Do you want to go for maybe the World Championship points and try to get here next year, or just enjoy your events with friends and go to your local stores? So it's definitely up there, and
And the great thing is, there's always a tournament somewhere.
Exactly.
The official tournament store locator on the website, you can go find places to play whenever you want.
Yep, just check it out. Make sure you go meet up with friends. You say, maybe I don't have anyone to duel with. I don't really know. Just show up. Just go to your local OTS. I guarantee there'll be people there ready to duel you and maybe help you with your deck and see what's going on.
And if you don't have a deck yet, or maybe you just like Yu-Gi-Oh, you like watching it, and you don't know really how to start, I would recommend Speed Duel.
Speed Duel is a fantastic
way to start.
I was about to say, many of the stories where you can check on, I have some demos so where they will explain to you how Speed Duel works, and you will get to actually see how it is, and it's really fun. It's essentially what we were talking about, a card version of the Duel Links. Mm-hmm. It's pretty relatable, so if you're having fun on Duel Links and catch up on the game, it's a way to do it, so it's very fun. It's just like the name suggests, very quick duels back and forth. It's so much fun. Me and Billy both had the chance, me in Italy and of course in the USA, to go to a Comic Con and compete for speed dueling against everyone, really. So it was a lot of fun for me, and I really enjoyed it. And new cards are coming out for the speed duels as well, which always makes things more interesting. So go check that out as well. It's a refreshing way of playing Yu-Gi-Oh!
And even if you're already playing Duel Links, one of the cool things about Speed Duel is that you can play with new skills that aren't in Duel Links.
Yeah, drastically different skills. Yeah, drastically different.
So a lot of people like the Dragon Collar skill, for instance. Yes. The Dragon Collar skill, which lets you assemble the Lord of Defu to summoning Dragon combo just by having one piece or the other.
It's one of the most powerful ones. We have similar decks in Duel Links with the Blue Eyes, but not quite as impactful as that one. And it was one of my favorites when I was playing Speed Duel, actually.
All right. So, Duel Links, it's coming soon. So, we're going to wait for our competitors to get up on stage. It looks like their stations have been placed there, and we'll be back shortly. Don't go away.
Good, good. We are now ready to proceed with the Yu-Gi-Oh! 2019 World Championship for the Duel Links Duelists. And first, I would like to introduce Takahiro Hamada. We have a video for you.
My name is Hamada Takahiro. I came from Japan to the Duel Links 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 自分が遊戯王カードを始めたのは小学校低学年ぐらいの頃で、そうですね、両親にカードパックを買ってきてもらったのが始めたきっかけですかね。思い出といたしましては、まあ自分兄弟がいまして、兄と一緒にやっていたんですけれども、自分が持ってるカードで一番高威力が高いのが巨大な会長っていうカードで、高威力が2000だったんですけども、 兄が持っているカードで一番攻撃力が高いのがフレームケルベロスという攻撃力2100のカードで、ちょっといつもその攻撃力の差で負けてしまっていたのを覚えています。自分のまあ性格特徴といたしましては、自分すごい人見知りをするんですね。でそれ、まあ、初対面の人と話すときとかはすごい緊張してうまく喋れなかったりしています。で例えば今とかもインタビュー中がすごい緊張してうまく喋れておりません。自分去年の大会に参加した際に、1日目予選ブロック中でお昼ご飯食べたんですけれども、ポカリセット1本だけでご飯が喉を通らなかったんですね。だから今年はちゃんとご飯を食べれるように頑張りたいです。去年の8月 WCS2018 年度の、まあ、大会で、まあ、なぜか自分が優勝してできてしまって、その時はすごい嬉しかったです。遊戯王以外の趣味としては、まあ、ボードゲームが趣味ですね。よくオンライン上で、まあ、いろいろとボードゲームがオンラインで遊べるサイトとかがあったりするんですけれども、そういったサイトでボードゲームをやったりしております。まあそうですね、チャンピオンを守るというよりも、ただ自分が持っているのは今年も幸運の女神に愛されたいです。
And Takahiro will be dueling against Shuhei Kobayashi
えー、僕の名前は小林と言います。僕はずっとその攻撃力が高いモンスターが強いと思っていたんですが、こうガジェットというデッキがありまして、でそのガジェットに当たった時、こう低い攻撃力ながら、蹂躙されまして、それがすごく記憶に残っています。今でも、あ、今がちょうど大学院生なんですけど、ちょうど修士論文の中間発表がありまして、それはすごくチャレンジングでした。僕の一番今までで良かった思い出は、やっぱりこの大会に来れるのを決めた大会で、やっぱりここにこの大会に出るっていうことをずっと目標に子どもの頃から思ってて、でそういう人もやっぱり周りにはたくさんいて、でもその中でやっぱり運よくここに来れたことが、来れるきっかけを得られたことが、僕はやっぱり一番の遊戯王のいい思い出ですかね。各地でっていうんですかね、ウィンドサーフィンがすごく好きで、よく外に出てやってますね。でこうウィンドサーフィンも遊戯王もすごく似ていて、やっぱり考えて勝つっていうところがすごく似通ってる気がしますかね。
Please welcome our duelists to the stage.
Hello everyone and welcome back to the World Championship 2019 here in Berlin. We are ready to throw down for the last time on Duel Links and we have a titan of a match. We have Takahiro Hamada back to defend his championship title versus Kobayashi, the challenger.
Yeah, we've been talking about Takahiro all weekend. He was a monster last year, easily took down the World Championship, didn't lose a game.
The Avengers called this guy and said, hey, we need a Duel Links guy. That's how good he is.
He is the man, and he's here again trying to win 2 years in a row so he could come back and try to go for a third one. Made it all the way here to the finals. He's been playing really well all weekend. I can't wait to see what is going to happen here in this final. Kobayashi has also been playing very well. We featured both of them many times this weekend. This is going to be one heck of a match.
Oh, yeah. So what are you guys' thoughts on the game? Who do you believe is going to win?
I think it's going to be Hamada. He was indestructible last year. It was...incredible to watch. He just dispatched people with so ruthless efficiency. And I wouldn't be shocked if we see more of the same this year.
He's kind of like a T-1000. I think he's come back from the future just to win at Duel Links. This guy is insane.
For sure. So for those of you who don't know, Duel Links is a little bit of a different format than the TCG players are used to. It's actually a best of five. So the first player to win 3 games will be declared the champion. They have 5 different decks with 5 unique characters with 5 unique skills.3 of the decks are standard decks, 2 of them are legendary decks. The legendary decks means that they have to use certain cards that the characters use in the show, like Kaiba, Blue Eyes White Dragon, Yugi, maybe Valkyrion or something. something along those lines. So it's pretty cool because you see a dynamic and you get to see different decks each game.
Yeah, mixing it up a little bit, and after you've won with a deck, you're not allowed to use it for the rest of the set, so there's always a strategic element of, do I take my best deck in first, or do I lead in with something I feel a little bit weaker, and then what's my opponent going to pick? Are they going to go strong first? It's difficult, right?
Yeah, picking which deck you pick is huge for the matchup against what you're facing. You can really determine the winner of the match.
It is a real mind game. Like, I don't know that I'd want to throw out my best deck first, right?
Yeah, you maybe want to say
maybe get the middle of the road deck first. Just try to see what's in my opponent's head before I, commit, my best deck to something. But even if you lose the first, you can still keep using that deck, can you not?
Yeah, that's absolutely right. And there's the thing. What if you win with your weaker deck first? Like, you get lucky, and then all of a sudden it's like, right, this is now very much downhill for me at this point.
Yeah, so or you just even with your weaker deck, you just have that throwaway game. You can lose two games, so it's okay if your weaker deck loses because you're still in it. You have to win a total of three games to win the match.
So in some way, you kind of end up with a bit of an advantage when your opponent locks down one of their decks and you still have the full flexibility for the rest of the match.
Indeed. That's one of the neat things about Duel Links. I love this format because it really rewards knowledge of the entire card pool, the entire skill pool as well. So these players have to master not just one deck, but a number of them. And they'll have to know basically every deck that's viable.
Yeah, and the skill cards are crazy how much of an impact they actually have on the game.
Oh yeah, these cards are completed better because of the dual skill that the players are using. Players are getting ready to sit down at the dual table, but until then we can take a look at what decks they have that they are using. It looks like Kobayashi could be starting with the Shizu Ishtar, which is one of my favorite characters in the game. She has the dual skill Sealed Tombs, which prevents any players from banishing or summoning any monsters from the graveyard to the end of your opponent's next turn.
Sounds an awful like one Necro Valley.
It is very similar.
One you can't interact with.
Because it is a skill card. That's right. They aren't actual cards.
Yeah, they just have
just abilities.
Yep, definitely.
Got some real exciting anime stuff there. Just character steps in and said, no, I'm just adding text to my card, and you're like, wait, what? You can do that?
It's not quite Stromberg level. That might be a little bit too much.
Yeah, that card was pretty crazy, to be honest. So, you believe Shizu is going to be the leading deck for Kobayashi? How about from Are? Hamada.
There you go.
Let's see what Hamada might be bringing here. Well, the classic order, Six Samurai deck.
The order is really challenging, but the Six Samurai deck, I recall, is extremely strong.
Yeah, it has a good matchup against almost everything, except for maybe Blue Eyes, which is the Shizu deck that we might see here this weekend. But the biggest problem with Blue Eyes is if you go first with Blue Eyes, you go first and you only have four cards, you have a chance to just draw only Blue Eyes White Dragons and not be able to make a play for your first turn, which we've seen happen multiple times this weekend.
I remember last year we had the Toon World issue, or Toon Kingdom in that case.
Oh, yeah.
One player kept playing the Toon deck, but never managed to get the card needed to play.
That was Tut Putt when he lost in the finals against Timmy for the first Duel Links World Championship.
Mm. Yep, that was an epic match.
Yeah, that's time right, is flying, right? It all kind of bleeds together.
I know.
Yu-Gi-Oh! Fans across the world, it's time to duel.
All right, we are ready to begin the Duel Links World Championship Final 2019, sponsored by Kadris.
All right, it looks like Hamada will be going second. Using Crowler with the Balanced Duel Skill. The Balanced Duel Skill says that if you have at least six different copies of a magic or spell, monster, or trap card, that you will open up with a more balanced hand, like maybe two traps, two spells, and a monster. Jaden Yuki probably using the dual skill that ties the binds, which for each monster on your side of the field, they will gain 100 attack. And yep, we do see the ties that bind Six Samurai. So the Six Samurai United is going to be activated here. And Sheen's Dojo, this is the opening you want to see here
this
from the Six
really
Samurai.
Strong. This is a good start.
Got to get those monsters, though.
Oh, double Dojo.
Double Dojo. Double Dojo.
Does he have the level 4 monster in his hand?
I know you'll help me out. I summon a monster.
He does.
It is. It's a Nishi.
Oh, it's a Nishi.
This is an ideal opening here from Kobayashi.
If you want a chance against the world champion, you're going to need a hand like this.
Yep. Dojo being activated. He's going to special summon the Fuma from his deck to the field.
You get a monster equal to the number of counters that it had.
Fuma being a level 1 tutor, just what he needs to be able to make a Sheehan.
And take some more cards for good measures.
Another Six Samurai United. A Synchro Summon coming down here for Sheehan. Sheehan's so powerful, just being able to negate a spell or trap that your opponent activates once per turn, and having the Fuma in your graveyard to be able to protect it from being destroyed.
It's so obnoxious, and if it sits around for even more than one turn, you're just falling so far behind.
And it's really easy to forget about that Secret Six Samurai Fuma effect in the graveyard as well.
Oh wow, this is huge that he drew
Kizan. Oh man.
Because now he gets to put enough counters on the dojo where he's going to be able to summon an Anishi from his deck, which is another interaction you'll be able to have during your opponent's turn to banish the two Six Samurais from your grave to return
Koba
monster.
Yeah, on your... Not messing around.
For sure not.
That gets him to, that fills up the Six Samurai United as well, does it not?
Absolutely.
He already had the counters at two, but decided to summon the dojo first so he doesn't draw into that Anishi, right. Thins his deck out a little more, try to draw into a trap card.
So this was really going to touch the metal of Hamada now.
If anyone can break this
board, just passes.
Oh no.
Yeah, there's not a whole lot, I think, to do about this.
Looks like this strong opening with Kobayashi might be enough to take down Hamada here in game one.
Hamada just decides to let it go.
This is a Japan versus Japan matchup. Both players know what they're doing. Oh no. There's Hamada no Sheer Kuribo. This game is over.
Yeah, he's just not buying in. He takes a look at his hand and says, there's no way. That is the absolute perfect Six Samurai start. And Kobayashi takes game one.
And he's now only two games away from winning the 2019 Duel Links World Championship here in Berlin.
So it looks like Kobayashi is a believer in putting your best foot forward first.
He comes out of the gate swinging.
Most definitely. Now, since this was a standard duel, the next duel will be between two legendary decks. Kobayashi has the pretty cool one. He has the Mako Tsunami legendary deck using Citadel Well and Jinx Undyne and Crystal Monsters.
Nice. I don't believe we've seen that so far this tournament, right?
We didn't see it on day one, but earlier today in the top cut, we've seen it a lot because Kobayashi was featured. And it's actually a really powerful deck, being able to synchro during your opponent's turn into the level 5 Crystal Synchro, which puts an opponent's monster in defense mode. And then you can lead up into the big level 9 synchro that requires two tuners and one non-tuner, but banishes three cards from your opponent's side of the field with 3,000 attack, 3,000 defense, and it's just fantastic. And on top of that, you still have the Citadel Well option, which is just a fantastic card that gets you the Sea Stealth attack, which is just so hard to deal with in Duel Links.
Yeah, definitely puts your opponent in a high-pressure situation when they have to deal with that on top of everything else going on.
But it looks like he is going to save that deck, and we do have a Yugimoto versus Yugimoto mirror match. We can expect both of these duels to be using Alpha, Beta, and Gamma, the Magnet Warrior combo. This will be incredible. This is my fight, and my fight alone. Using cards like Berserkion, they're both using 30 cards and cards like that, Grassless Greener. So in the mirror match here, it's important to queue up with the same deck, making your opponent's grasses almost worthless. But you see Gamma coming down, and Gamma's going to let him special summon a monster from his hand. I special
summon a monster. Kobayashi decides to start with Alpha, the Electro Magma Warrior.
This is huge. This is an ideal opening. Gamma into Alpha. Alpha's going to be able to search the Berserkion from his deck and add it to his hand. And all of the new Magnet Warriors with the effects have also the cool effect during your opponent's turn. You can tribute them off and special summon a Magnet Warrior from your deck to the field.
And this starts filling up your graveyard for the Berserkion a little bit later, filling your deck out.
Oh no, yeah, normal summoning a Beta is not the way you want to start this game. So things aren't off to a great start here for Hamada, but he does have the two face down cards.
And we see the ties that bind again.
Pretty solid dual skill. My monster's effect activates. So he's going to use the Gamma effect to tribute off to special summon, probably a Delta here from his deck. Yep, we see Delta come down, and when Delta summons, he's going to be able to send any Magnet Warrior from his deck to the graveyard. And Delta also has that bonus effect. If it is sent to the graveyard and you can banish three Magnet Warriors besides itself, you can special summon Valkyrion from your deck to the field. So he's going to try and attack the Alpha now. The Alpha's going to use its effect to tribute off to special summon. Yugi said it best. Special summon monster from his deck. Another Delta of the Magnet Warrior. I end
my turn. Just forcing him out of the pass.
Yep. Because if he ever attack it, he'd be able to banish his three magnets from his grave and summon Valkyrion. Oh, wow. And Beta. That's a one of.
That completes a set right there that Kobayashi needed.
Beta able to search for any Magnet Warrior from his deck, so he's going to grab Alpha. Alpha being really strong to be able to search for Berserkion, and here comes the first Berserkion.
Banishing all three for the mighty Berserkion.
Activate Berserkion's effect, banish to destroy the face down card, and he's going to be able to do it again.
advantage. Destroy your other face down. Put my monsters into attack mode. If Hamada doesn't have a Sir Karibo here, things just end very quickly.
He's hurting. He's hurting real bad right now.
Oh, man. Kobayashi off to such a strong and swift start. One after these attacks, he'll be one game away from becoming the 2019 Duel Links World Champion, taking down arguably the best Duel Links player in the world. I don't know if it's much of an argument.
This is like an underdog story. It's crazy. Kobayashi just dominating those first two games. Not even close.
Just game like two. That. Kobayashi one game away from dethroning Hamada.
I wonder if Hamada's just taking it easy and now he's like, okay, now I'm going to show up.
You got to make it a show. You
just
know?
Giving himself a handicap?
He could be. He's the kind of guy that would do that.
I don't know about that. That's a little risky for the finals, don't you think?
It would be a little risky, but think of the story.
Yeah, yes. All these people watching
just
here and at home.
Yeah, planned. Actually planned.
since that was our legendary duel, we're going back to the standard decks duel. I see what the duelist might be picking up. I'm assuming that Kobayashi is going to go with Sartorius in the Master of Destiny dual skill. It's one of the most powerful decks in Duel Links right now. This dual skill says, let's see who they pick before I let you know what the dual skill does, but I'm pretty sure he's going to pick this deck because I think it's the best deck. Yep.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, he's going with Sartorius. So the Master of Destiny dual skill, if you have five different cards in your deck with different names, unique cards, that have the effect of flipping coins, the first three coin flips you have for your game in your match, will all be heads, guaranteed. So cards like Cup of Ace become really good. The Desperado Barrel Dragon will guarantee be able to flip three.
And then the Lumis and Umbra deck that uses the light and dark skill.
Yep, so if he has a light monster in his hand, he'll be able to swap it out for a dark, and dark, he'll be able to swap for a light. And he's using six samurais with that dual skill. So here he goes, using the light and dark. Yeah, Lumis Umbra are newer characters to Duel Links, but have been highly impactful, with every dual skill they have being almost one of the best ones in the game.
All right, and so he swaps out Inishi for Legendary Secret of the Six Samurai.
Here comes Shin's Dojo. Shin's Dojo was so powerful it had to be semi-limited in the game. And the semi and forbidden list is our limited list is a little different in Duel Links. If a card's limited to two, you can only use up to two copies in your deck of any card that's semi-limited.
And you can only use one card off the limited list as well.
Yep, same way.
Yeah, forcing players to make really tough choices in deck building.
Here comes an ideal opening to Synchro Summon for Shein. Now, if he doesn't have a Keys on in his hand, he won't be able to get that. He'll be able to get that Nishi by specifying the Keys on and having four counters on the Dojo. If not, he could also send the Dojo away just to summon a Fuma from his deck to the field. And if his opponent tries to destroy that Shein, he could destroy the Fuma instead. Fuma's effect will trigger, special summon the Nishi from his deck, and he'll have the Nishi for the bounce, which just looks like what we might be seeing here. So it's kind of just like another layer of protection. Yep, here comes the Fuma.
There she is.
This looks like a strong start from Hamada.
And another face down, and that's it. Hamada's like, this is what I gotta do. Even though he's down 2-0 here in the finals, you can see he seems unfazed, stoic, and ready to defeat his opponent. If anyone can make this comeback, it's definitely Hamada.
Time wizard! And it's going to work.
It is guaranteed to flip and guaranteed to work. And its head's gonna destroy all his opponents.
Oh, it's his lucky day!
Destroys both his monsters, just like that, but the Fuma effect will trigger when it's destroyed. And he'll be able to get that Inishi from his deck to the field. If he chooses Inishi. Or he could probably just go with it is going to be Inishi.
He does go with Inishi, yeah.
And Cup of Ace. So the dual skill lets the first three all be heads. So since he still has the two extra heads, it's guaranteed he's going to flip two and draw two cards here.
And I do love how they do the rotating card animations for Sartorius like they were in the GX anime.
Yeah, it's really cool. There's a lot of like little details that are in Duel Links that are just fantastic. They make it such a great game. Oh, so we see the dual wield coming down.
Dual wield.
As long as he has only one face-up attack with six samurai monster, he'll be able to bounce two cards on his opponent's side field back to the hand. So he sends both the back rows back and sets the spell and trap card face down. And Anishi's going to take down this time wizard.
Not quite as aggressive as I'm used to seeing out of Six Samurai.
Yep, sometimes you gotta deal with the time
like
you
dual wield two more monsters, I win.
Yep, dual wield is such a strong trap card, especially in Duel Links.
Yeah, much reduced life points, the damage is so much higher in this format.
Alright, this is Hamada's, his tournament life is right here on this Inishi. Is it gonna be a Bomber Spider? Oh, Twin Barrel Dragon! This won't be guaranteed, so it's up to...
Yeah, you only get the first heads.
Yep, let's see if he gets to get two heads. Oh, no, only one. But it is a dark machine that will be able to destroy itself by attacking the Anishi. And if he has a Desperado Barrel Dragon in his hand, he'll be able to special summon it. The dark machine is destroyed. And we do see the Desperado Barrel Dragon coming out here.
I shall play this. I special summon a monster.
Here comes Desperado Dragon. That is one powerful card.
Yeah, it has 2,800 attack, and during the battle phase, you can flip three coins, and for each heads, he gets to destroy that many monsters on the opponent's side of the field. And if he flips all three heads, he also gets to draw a card. So he has, it has a quick effect that can actually interact during your opponent's turn.
Yeah, it's powerful that you can just summon it during the battle phase like that, clearing out the field and getting the damage in.
It is one of the best cards that has ever been released in Duel Links, for sure. Oh man, this isn't looking good for Amada.
Just a T-set.
Hopefully the monster set is a Fuma, but it would be the third Fuma. Going to battle phase? Is it the third Fuma?
It is the third Fuma.
So the Fuma is going to be able to special summon Anishi from his deck again, so hope is not completely lost for Armada, but bouncing the Desperado Barrel Dragon back in hand isn't the greatest because he'll be able to summon itself again, but he has to do what he can. This is his tournament on the line.
What would you guess the face down monster is? Probably a Blast Spider, right?
Yeah, probably a Blast Spider. Maybe a Dacoichi.
The little train that could, that draws more cards.
That Battle Enchanted Locomotive. It's interesting, he decided to set the Unite as a glove instead of having it face up already, but he decides to activate it here. Draws a Kizan, I'm assuming. Yeah, we kind of get a little hint by the character lines of what's going to come down. Destiny laughs
at you. Oh, Desperado Barrel Dragon is blocking out.
Is it Treacherous Trap
Hole
there? Trap activates. Oh, Dust Tornado. Destroying some Samurai United. So Amada's going to have to use the Anishi effect here just to bounce the Desperado Barrel Dragon. So he could bounce it back to the hand, attack the monster. If it's a dark machine, it would just come down and he'll be able to use the effect to destroy his monster. So he doesn't want that to happen. So he might just see straight to the end phase here for Amada. Heads up play. Because now he has a chance if Kobayashi summons the Desperado anytime before his battle phase, like maybe during main phase one, the Anishi will be able to bounce it back to the hand and just kind of delay. And just so maybe get enough attacks in there to reduce his life to zero.
So Hamada needs to drag this out a few more turns.
Yep, he's doing what he can with what he has. Oh, wow.
Ooh.
Paleozoic Canadian.
Candina.
Putting Anishi. Yep. Decides to put the keys on face down.
Because you do need another six samurai.
Choo choo! Here he comes! Dacoichi!
Dacoichi. Blast from the past. The Battle Enchanted Locomotive drawing a card here. Is it going to be the Bomber Spider?
It is.
It's
Blast
Spider.
Spider.
Activates the effect. Destroys a dark machine to destroy an opponent's monster. And since a dark machine is destroyed, he gets to summon that Desperado Barrel Dragon from his hand.
I shall play this.
Forms
the
chain.
He knows.
Looking excited.
He knows he's got it.
Kobayashi. He's going to do it.
He's going to take down Takahiro Hamada 3-0 and win the Duel Links 2019 World Champion.
He's sweeping him.
What a fantastic
Unbelievable.
Final.
Somebody finally puts Hamada down. That's insane. And it was a sweep, a 3-0 sweep.
Fantastic. Yeah, still coming in second place is a huge feat. Winning the previous year and coming in second the next year, that shows that he has to be one of the best, if not the best, Duel Links player in the world. But on today, Kobayashi is now the new world champion.
Kobayashi, great work. That was incredible.
It really, really was.
Congratulations, Kobayashi.
Top man, taking it down. Have some confetti.
The Yu-Gi-Oh! Duel Links 2019 world champion, Shusei Kobayashi. You very, very welcome. How are you feeling? Well, congratulations! Another round of applause. Well done. Please leave that over there. Also, we would like to ask I'm here to inform you that we'll take another 10-minute break, but right after that, please come right back as we continue for our world championship. Thank you so much.
Well, that wasn't what I was expecting to see today.
No, that is not how I saw that going down at all.
What a match.
Kobayashi, congratulations on being the next world champion.
So, I'm still stunned. Yeah, it's something what I just
there are no words.
Well, the words are congratulations, Kobayashi. Honestly, that was great. Although we saw that God Hand Six Samurai, I think anybody even in advanced constructed format with a hand like that would have been happy.
Yeah, I remember that from the Storm of Ragnarok days as well.
They have all the same cards. Every one of them, you know, not, the only one, Gateway's not around.
They got more now.
They have better cards than maybe they came out.
Yeah,
there was
no Fuma back in the old days. You had these Kageki.
Yeah, they also have Kageki and Kagemusha. Yeah, the classic combo. But yeah, showing the power and the consistency of the decks he brought. Each deck he brought to this tournament, very powerful. I'd be able to go first with a strong opening and just utterly annihilate his opponent.
Yeah, from fantastic games right there, and
you can still hear the celebrations in the background.
Yeah, it's going crazy. It's going to be really interesting to see how well Kobayashi does next year. Honestly, he's already got his ticket now to the next World Championships, and we might see Hamada coming back again.
Yeah, Japan showing how dominant they are in duelings. They won two World Championships in a row. Both of the players in the finals are from Japan. Just fantastic, fantastic to all the players. And just being able to make it to the Duel Links World Championship is very difficult. I would almost say it's even harder than making it to the TCG World Championship because you have to play for so many days on end, and you have to be ranked number one in the world in most of the cases out of anyone else that's playing that weekend, which is actually just hard feat.
It's tough. I know a lot of friends of mine back home have tried it, and you know, after two
I've tried it many a time.
Maybe I'm out.
Yeah, it's usually like day three, like 6 hours in, and I'm just like, nope, I can't do it.
You
I'm going to sleep.
A coffee, and your hands are shaking. You're like, I'm going to play this trap card. I'm going to make it happen. Go to Worlds.
We got this. Yeah, a great match, though. Fantastic. Big congratulations to Kobayashi. He played really well all weekend in every feature match we had him. And Hamada, no slouches either. Having second place is not a bad thing. He's definitely still gets a prize card, still fantastic finish, and proving himself to be one of the best Duel Links players, undisputedly.
Absolutely. I wouldn't. If someone said, you have to beat this guy to keep your job, I'd be like, okay, guys, I'll see you next time. It's been a pleasure. I wouldn't go head-to-head with that guy.
For sure.
All right, well, that's going to close it out for the Duel Links World Championship Finals. Up next is the All-Ages TCG Finals. We're going to get to that right after we get the stage back set up. So hang in there.
Looks like we're still going to be on here for a few minutes, so let's sit here and talk with you guys.
Welcome back. This is the 2019 Yu-Gi-Oh! Trading Card Game World Championship, and you are just in time for the finals of the All Ages division of the World Championship. We have one last duel to close out this 2018-2019 season, and I'm sure that it's going to be a thriller.
Yeah, it's been a crazy ride so far, and we're going to get to see another former world champion trying to defend their title, Qixing Wang versus Koki Kosaka.
Yeah, we had a lot of action throughout this weekend, a lot of the duels, three different tournaments going on at the same time, one the Dragon Duel, the Duel Links. We already have our world champions for those two categories. The first one, Dragon Duel, coming from Taiwan. The second one, Duel Links, coming from Japan. So what do we have here for the TCG is Koki Kosaka, he is from Japan, and of course the reigning world champion from Taiwan. That means that regardless of the outcome of this match, either Taiwan or Japan will have two world champions today. So that's going to be definitely insane, and I feel like they're going to have a very good match. Once more, no surprises. We spoiled it for you a little bit earlier. They're both playing the same deck, both Salaman Great, different approaches. And I was very surprised by the previous match where the defending world champion for Duel Links was defeated swiftly in a 3-0 manner. But I'm very curious to see if this will happen again. We saw the same deck for Wang in the Dragon Duel finals because he was friends with the actual world champion from Dragon Duel. And now we will see if the same card-by-card decklist will be able to get him there for this TCG. So
yeah, this will be really interesting. Kosaka was actually one of the players that when we asked the Japanese commentary teams, like, absolutely, hey, highlight us your best player, they all pointed directly to this guy and said, hey, this is the guy to keep an eye on. And he's going up against the former world champion who's now just climbed all the way through over an arena of fallen champions just to stand on top with these last two duelists.
And this field in particular was really tough. There are a lot of former world championship competitors.
Absolutely. It was. We saw both of these guys already on stream, of course. They tear through the toughest competition I've seen in years very easily, and their decks are very similar. That's not a surprise. I think, though, that we are getting ready for the show to begin with, so hold on to your seat. It all comes down to this one final match. Who will be crowned world champion?
Let's get down to business.
Hello there, and we're back. Is everybody excited? Fantastic. Well, it is my privilege to introduce to you our final two duelists. Our first is Qixing Wang.
My name is Wang Jiaqing, I'm 28 years old, I'm a Taiwan representative. Because I've seen this 卡通嘛, 就觉得他的怪兽都很帅, 然后就跟着朋友一起玩这个游戏, 一直玩到现在。 在德国的话, 食物吃的比较不习惯, 那还有就是语言吧, 因为跟国外的选手, 怕会比上次有遇到一些奇怪的纷争, 然后可能在语言的沟通上, 会跟对手沟通不良, 主要是以上这两点, 会让我比较觉得麻烦, 需要具有一定的挑战性。 比较让我印象深刻的是, 我在台湾, 第一次打那个比赛打冠军的时候吧，因为我以前打了很久的比赛，大概打了十几年，都打不太上去，所以去年第一次在台湾夺冠会是我印象最深刻的一次，也是我自己想的战术有奏效的一次。平常周末的话，除了打游戏王，那还会可能跟朋友去运动吧，打个球之类的。对，就不要除了坐着打游戏王之外，身体还是要起来动一动。 我今年是比去年带着更大的信心来到这个赛场，因为我比去年花了更多的准备时间、更多的心力来准备这场比赛，所以我很有信心能够拿下这次第二个冠军。It
is also my privilege to introduce our other duelist for the title of the world champion, Koki Kosaka.
小坂幸喜
日本です。子供の時にそのパック向いて得たワクワクをなんかその今勝負に生かせてるのがなんか思い出としていいかなっていう。やっぱ言葉の壁でちょっと寂しい気持ちになるなっていうのはありましたね。日本の数多くの知り合いがやっぱ代表になってて、それに感化されて自分も今年初めて挑戦して、まあ、今ここにいることが一番印象的っていうか、そんな気持ちです。遊戯以外は特にやってなくて、もう遊戯を一筋です。
Well said. Please help me welcome our duelists to the stage.
All right, it's all come down to this. Our players are taking their seats. They'll have their headphones on soon and they'll be able to get in the zone and prepare for this match.
Yeah, your heart must be going at 1,000 beats a minute right now, right? If you're sitting on that stage, everybody watching, everybody at home, all of your friends and family, this match must mean so much to these guys.
And you're the last match of the day as well. All eyes are on you.
Yeah, it is always stressful to play on the future match area for anyone going to big events like YCS's or even the WCQ's. But for this particular event, I think it gets completely out of the way. You have an insane live crowd here watching and supporting you. And I think that's just completely different, because when you're focusing on yourself and you're thinking, okay, I have this 1,000 people watching me home, it's different. But when you just look up and you see all this crowd there, it really gets you. And I'm very curious to see if it will influence their plays. As Wang said, he has the advantage because he already been there and he won last year. So he knows how it feels, and he wants to defend his title badly. Koki on his other side, though, I'm very curious. I didn't know about him being a close friend to Ryosuke, the champion in 2017, where me and Billy actually were in Tokyo. It means that he has a friend supporting him, that he's a world champion. So he definitely wants to make him and everyone else proud. He said that his main passion is Yu-Gi-Oh! So I'm pretty sure, and I was impressed by how he's playing. So I think they both have really good chances. They have, I think, among the best deck list we have seen in the entire 28 TCG competitors. So no surprise that they are both here competing for the final title.
Yeah, that's a good point about him being friends with Ryosuke Sugimura. Normally, the only way to prepare for the World Championship is going there once, and generally you get beat pretty bad, and then you want to get back again now that you have an idea of what it is. It's like that in a lot of sports. You know, the first time you make the playoffs as a team, you don't know what it's like. The intensity ratchets up. And you might have an early exit but come back stronger next year. But if you're friends with the former world champion, you can get some pointers early on.
Absolutely, you can get some tips, and I think he did, because you can really see the difference between his deck list and what everyone else brought. Since the field is so small and you have only 5 rounds of Swiss, which means that to be crowned world champion, you only need to win 8 matches, or not even all of the 8 matches, of course. His decklist is really unique in the sense that he's maining a lot of cards that you usually see in the side decks, just because he wants to steal those games. It is not an event where you have like 17, 16, 15 rounds where you have to rely more on consistency. Here, you can take more risk. And I feel like for both of these guys, their decklist reflects on that. It's a high risk, high reward kind of choice. It is paying out, and for one of them, it will pay out even more. So
yeah, I feel like you have to take risks in this type of format. When everyone is so strong and so close in their skill levels, you have to have a bigger payoff than they can get in order to stay up and stay in the race with them, honestly.
And part of that is being able to predict the field accurately. You got to take, you know, what's going on overseas, what's going on in your home country, what might change as a result of bringing the two together, and try to decide, you know, what is going to be played? How do I beat that? If I'm going to play the same deck as I think the majority of the field is playing, then I have to take some of those risks, maybe main deck those side deck cards.
Absolutely, and they both, just as a reminder for everyone watching, playing again Salaman Great, they are aware of it, and they had very good predictions, because out of the 28 players in our tournament, 13 of them were actually playing Salaman Great. Almost half of the field was the deck. They really built their own to beat it and to beat the mirror match, and this, I think, will be the toughest challenge that either of them basically have to come up, because now you're facing someone who has the same mindset and the same deck as you. So there is no more having that much of an edge yet in previous rounds like we saw throughout their previous future matches. So it is definitely going to be the closest one yet.
No surprises left, basically.
Yeah, I mean, you'd have just logged onto the stream overnight. You'd have been researching your possible opponents. You'd have watched their features. You'd have gone back over the games over and over and over again. You were definitely prepared with what's going to happen next.
Absolutely, and just to make everyone aware of what those particular changes between the usual are, they are both maining Mind Control, a card that it was never popular to begin with in Salaman Great especially, and it's there because of the mirror match mainly. They're not siding it, they're both maining it, so both having an advantage, but I do have to admit that if I compare the deck list, the current world champion Wang Chai Ching actually has even more of an advantage, maining Didi Crow's Phantasme, and it really shaped his deck to beat the mirror match. As a reminder, once more, his friend did it at the Dragon Duel Championship, so I really gotta say that if someone has the edge here, it is Wang, but it is gonna be very close, and there isn't a safe bet, I'd say.
That's one thing that I found really fascinating about Kosaka's list, is that he doesn't have Phantasme on there. Just at all. That's something that's been kind of a staple of Salaman Great the entire time that it's been a competitive deck.
Yeah, most of our competitors playing this card, I believe, over the weekend as well, to great effect.
Absolutely, and especially in Salaman Great, you see it quite often, and his deck is completely different. Basically, for everyone, I think, in this TCG side, unfortunately, once more, we do not have a finalist from either, the TCG area, we can say. I feel one of the problems was that we did receive a new TCG forbidden list that wasn't applied for this event, and a lot of the players from TCG actually thought that combo decks were still very good because of the limitation not applying. Koki, for example, realized that that was not the case, and he's not maining that many entrops. That's a great decision, because if you play against the mirror match of Salaman Great, you don't want to be stuck with all these entrops that don't really advance your plan. And he caught even the Phantasme, which I gotta say is so brave on his side, but it's working out for him. Mm-hmm. He only lost one match throughout the entire event right now, and he has, I think, very good chances to even take this. So
yeah, it's interesting you bring up combo that it didn't do very well.
Absolutely.
Out of the top eight, I believe only one of them.
Yeah, I mean, the Dakota Angel of the North American champion made it all the way to top four, but he was the only player who was nicked in eighth place with an X2 record, so he wasn't like guaranteed to make it. So that really shows you how it seems like it was more of a fragile choice. And in the end, you gotta give credits to the OCG players. So even though we are playing in Europe this time, they still proved that they are the best for this year. So
I do wonder, like when you compare to last year, like the differences is you had the OCG almost felt like it was at a disadvantage because the format was so different on their side with missing cards like Crystal Needle Fiber. And then the TCG players did really well last year. Ultimately, Chai actually did win the World Championship.
Yep.
But this year, we're looking at like the TCG sides missing all of the danger monsters and all the stuff they've gotten used to for competitive play. And not all of those cards are not legal for this event. So I'm wondering like how much that sort of had an impact on them.
I think they did a good job of trying to substitute for them, but you know, it wasn't enough.
Yeah, and to be honest, I think they did have a very good show. We had, I think, five TCG players in the top eight.
Yes.
So unfortunately, all of the Europeans lost immediately. And yep. Then we had two, so one from Panama, of course, and one from the USA in the top four, which means they still had a good show. It is just that they didn't get to the finals, which does matter, but our players, I believe, rolled their dice, which is going to be relevant in this matchup. And if they're ready, I would just say, let's go. This is the last match, everyone watching. This comes down to this. Who will be the TCG World Champion for 2019?
already wiping the sweat from his brow.
Those lights are pretty hot, and there's no time limit, so you're in that chair till the game is done.
Take one last deep breath.
Yes, and there you just go. You can see how focused they are.
This is it. We have now come to the final duel of the day, where we will crown the ultimate duelist for the Yu-Gi-Oh! Trading Card Game World Championship 2019, held here in Berlin, Germany. Yes. Good luck, duelists. And as always, trust in the heart of the cards. It's time to duel!
Unfortunately, Zen is mostly relying on those go second cards that we were mentioning. Both mind control going first and not what you want to see. So this part of this area will be the deciding factor for this game. He really needs to pick up some of the engine cards. And luckily for him, Chai did not open a single Entrop. So
let's see where Kozak is going. It's off these top two cards. Take a breath, take a look.
And there is a sign in mining there, so that's definitely what he wanted to see. Now the next step is slowly check those 10 banished cards for a gazelle.
It's so
and it's the first card, wow!
It's so dangerous running Wild Desires when you only have one copy of your key card.
They are both playing Desires. Throughout the previous future matches, he's never really let them down. Now it did, and this is gonna hurt a lot. Gazelle, just as a reminder, is at one for this event, so he's completely cut off from that, which is...
Wow, that's brutal.
Brutal.
That's brutal to be starting off the finals just like that.
It's tough. I guess you have to start leaning in on maybe on Jack Jaguar.
Yeah, it's...
Just keep getting monsters on the field. It's not an easy one, though.
It seems like he's passed. Yeah, I was about to say he's...
One good thing, though, is that he only needs one monster because he can use his opponents.
Yeah, with exactly. The double mind control there.
And the really cool interaction in the mirror match is Ita. So if your opponent, or you can prevent your opponent from getting back the gazelle with the wolf, then you can steal their own gazelle and use it as your own. So that's still an option for Koki. And I think he's going to really rely on that because his hand is not looking anywhere good at the moment if Chai doesn't overextend here. So
would you say with these two pieces of interaction that Koki is pretty safe from being OTK'd here?
Should be, but it really depends on what Chai has. And at the moment, I think his end also relies a lot on the part of Desire. Yeah. So they overall have very similar ends. But it is quite different. So at least he will be able to fin through his deck. And something that we have seen previously from Chai was playing around the Phantasme from their opponents when they didn't really have much going on. So. Let's see. Again, one Desires, who is going to have the better Desires? It really might just come down to this for this game one.
Another cool thing with Will of the Salamander right there, summoning from hand.
Let's see. This draws a super important.
Do we see the double the Gazelle taken out of the game?
Unfortunately, we are not able to see those cards. But
just tilt those cards slightly further forward.
Yeah.
Never mind.
Would have been interesting to see them, but the draws are pretty solid, so Foxy and Spinny both being useful in this spot.
Besides, a little mystery is good for the soul. Yu-Gi-Oh! Was kind of built on it, really, with trap cards, face downs, that sort of thing.
Ever since day one.
Okay, and he just attacks with both. Again, it's quite possible that he will just hand here, maybe on Abyss Dweller, which is an even better way to play around the Phantasme. Let's see what he thinks is the optimal choice here.
It's just a tough set of cards.
He does just pass. There. So, as he did in. Ooh, and a third mind control is picked up.
Wow.
Well, those are definitely getting played this turn.
Yeah, now he has a chance, of course.
Might be nice to take those two monsters and keep them stuck under an Xyz monster of your own.
It's definitely interesting. He has quite a few options. The Twin Twister isn't that great in this matchup. Luckily for him, since Chai was playing around Bay Lynx, there isn't any protection at the moment. And the Sign of Money comes down. Right now, the only interaction from Chai is the Diddy Crow. Again, very relevant that he decided to main deck triple. I think he is the only one in the entire field that decided to go for this, and it is paying out greatly. So
he's got his hand on the Jack Jaguar there. Is that or Foxy? Running some numbers in his head.
Yeah, because at the moment he's quite short of another level 3, since Chia didn't really commit to it, so even the Ita wouldn't get him there, so maybe he could go for a Foxy and try to get a Spinny or something else to get going.
He's got to have a high concentration of Salamangreat cards left in his deck at this point, because he hasn't seen any so far. Mind Control number 1 is activated, taking Gia's Jack Jaguar.
So from here, it also depends if he might have banished the Sanctuary as well, honestly. That would hurt even more, so...
Man, hitting 2 1-ofs with 1 Desires. Not good odds on that.
That's a risky run when you're running very slim 1-ofs with Pot of Desires in your deck.
Takes control of both of the Salamangreat monsters.
Mind Control, a great card in last year's finals as well.
It was.
And I think we can safely assume that both of these guys might have watched it, and in particular, Chia was playing it, might have picked up on Bowden's idea to run Mind Controls. So
interesting. So summons Foxy, no effect.
And just that sucks with it, yeah.
Main phase 2.
It is possible that he just wants to use it to clear the will. Mm. In that case, it is much better to use it that way. Because he knows his opponent also doesn't have too much going on at the moment, so it is... And luckily, the Sanctuary wasn't banished. It would have been really too rough if he lost 2 of his best cards.
So that is...
Yeah, Foxy come down. But the Diddy Crow here is gonna hurt, so...
Ooh. Gets tagged.
If it was any other entrap here, you can see the difference. Since Foxy activates in the graveyard, but the effect to destroy a spell entrap doesn't activate in a new chain, you cannot negate it with like Effect Veiler or Impermanence.
Right.
And usually you see those entraps here, for example, if Chia had that, he couldn't negate the Foxy, but the Diddy Crow paying off.
He is going to get to keep those Salamangreats out of Chia's graveyard, though, as he Xyz summons Baguska, the
yes.
terribly tired taper.
Billy's favorite number, as he mentioned on stream previously, number 41, so...
Just take a rest, take a timeout.
Baguska has kind of a debilitating effect while it's in defense mode, switching things to defense and negating their effects. Link monsters, of course, can't be in defense position as they have no defense points. And
okay.
So they're safe.
So now a Cosmic Cyclone is picked up, and you can see one of the differences between his deck and the other ones. He is maining the Fusion of Fire, which is quite an impactful tool in the mirror match. And at the moment though, since you don't usually see the number 41 on the field, it's not gonna be as good as usual because it would prevent the Violet Chimera and it would put it in defense position, so.
Yeah, that's a card that's been cut from a lot of extra decks, at least in North America. So always a little surprised by it.
Definitely. I think it depends heavily on the if you're running multiple targets, for example, for Super Polymerization that takes away a slot because of Starving Venom usually, so you're less inclined to play it because Abyss Dweller is usually considered the better one. But he's playing both, so he thought the card was relevant enough in the mirror match and in other matchups as well.
Just taking some time in a tank to think this play through.
Sets a monster face down.
Okay.
Not something you really see in Salamangreat, and it's generally a sign that things have not gone to plan.
Absolutely. The thing is, number 41 is actually very annoying to deal with, because
Right now you can see his only very good play would have been a Stallio, but Stallio of course would have been negated. So, and finally an engine card is picked up by Kogi. He gets the circle. Just as a reminder, if anyone just tuned in, there is no Gazelle for Kogi. It was banished by the stars, so he has to try and play and navigate this game differently. So.
Now the downside to Baguska is that you can't always, you know, press your advantage in this case. So Chiaz kind of has a weaker setup here with just a face down monster, and you know, maybe it really is a weaker position, or maybe he's just trying to get that Baguska switch to attack position so that its effect stops.
I think there, a material also has to be detached, which means that he will get back one of his Solomon Grave Master. Well,
on the standby phase.
Yeah. Which I think it is what the judges are catching up on right now. So he gives back the Jaguar to his opponent, but he's able to use even the third mind control right now. This is wild, yeah.
So he knows what that face down monster is. Looks like it is a Falco.
It's it should be Spinny, maybe? I think it was the Spinny set, yeah. So the Spinny is there. It's flipped, not in defense position, of course, but we are skipping the number 41, putting it into defense, so. It will be interesting to see how he goes for this, so. He might want to push some damage, and the Ita is a possibility, which I think we could see soon. Because you can also switch the number 41 to attack position, of course, to push some damage. So that's what he's going for. Because now, if you get back the Jaguar from the graveyard and you normal summon your own copy of Jaguar, then this is a lot of damage and it would be enough to actually win the game. So I think Kogi is in a really good spot to take this first duel. So he is still in the line. So
double Jack Jaguar with Hita and Baguska.
19. This is more than enough. It's
36 plus 54,
74, plus 100
it's a lot.
Pretty much. So
it's
it should be enough. Let's see if, they do realize it. So Kogi wins game one. Nice applause from the crowd. And
does it without the Gazelle as well.
And without really getting a whole lot of Salamandra
this is
cards.
Really, if you had any doubts about the favorite for our colleagues and Japanese friends, now you don't doubt him. Like, he managed to activate a desire, banish his only copy of Gazelle, and still found a way to win, drawing triple mind control going first. So it is not something you see every day, and very, very well played by him.
That was a clunky hand that he turned into some real action there. That was a great play by Kosaka.
Yes.
That's part of why you have to practice a lot, is you have to get those cards and not to be like, yeah, no, I can't do anything. You have to figure out what you can do, not even if it's not what you want to do.
Absolutely. And now we're going to go to the side decks where things do get a little different. So both, as we were saying, we're maining a lot of cards already for the mirror match, but they do add a few. What was the most interesting for me, especially in Qing deck, is that his main deck is very focused on multiple copies of cards. His side deck, almost all of one-offs, which is something you don't see every day. Billy agreed with me earlier on that it is something that he likes, just to see different copies of cards. But for example, he decided to only play one Super Polymerization when that card is very impactful in this matchup. So maybe that decision will go back to him. So
I guess he already has one Fusion of Fire, which is kind of like a second copy for the
Absolutely,
mirror.
Yeah.
On, a lot of times for the one-offs, one reason you might do it is if you have six different cards that can interact with something, but they all have you can only use this effect once per turn written on them. So you might need a bunch of similar effects, because if you drew multiple copies of a single card, you wouldn't be able to play them both in one turn. But if you draw two copies of two different cards, like say an Ash Blossom and a Ghost Ogre, you could use them both, and it improves your overall hand quality.
It's interesting. If you have this situation where you have lots of one-offs in your side deck, would you leave the Pot of Desires in, or do you start thinking about taking it out?
I mean, I think you take into consideration the fact that you have Pot of Desires when you build the side deck. So. Since they're not engine cards, you're not really afraid to banish the one-offs. It is probably just similar to what Jerome was saying. If you play multiple copies of the same card with restrictions and you have draw effects, you're more likely to draw multiples and then they are not that good. When you have all these one-offs, you can actually use it very safely and
get the best of both worlds, we can say. And that's what's gonna happen. He's probably putting in his Imperial Order, Super Polymerization, and Ghost Bell, which are all one-offs he has in his side decks for different purposes, so...
If you're watching at home, one thing to think about when you're using Pot of Desires is you gotta think about whether you're trying to draw one specific card or one card out of a group of cards. If it's a group of cards, then you can almost treat all of them as whatever single card you're looking for. And that alters the math and makes it safer to run a card like Pot of Desires.
Yeah, otherwise you end up going the safer route of just play free of everything.
That's sometimes a possibility. In this case, of course, they have to respect the restrictions. And in this deck, it is more of a fact of there are that many engine cards. You cannot really go above it. So if you already have your combos going on, you keep the Desires, you fin your deck for the Gazelle and the Sanctuary, and then you hope to draw traps or entraps with it. Otherwise, if you did not have engine cards, then it would have been any other cards. Why not risk it and just try and get into your combos? And it is working out, because both of them are playing Desires right now.
Strong card from release.
Just getting the last minute shuffle before we jump into game two of this best of three for the Yu-Gi-Oh! World Championships 2019.
There is also a word in which Ching actually picks the second. Took out his opponent off guard, but he would need to be very brave to do so. And it is something that I do like because, first of all, they don't expect it, and they side cards that are gonna be useless going first. So let's see if he decides to go for that line.
Much more balanced hand on Kosaka's side this time around.
He does have the Gazelle, so no more risks of getting that away.
Now it's safe to play the Desires.
Absolutely. And he really is good at drawing his mind controls. He has two more copies this game, so five mind controls just in basically 10 or 15 minutes is, you gotta feel sick if you're Ching, so.
This time though, if you're going second, it might be a little better than last time.
Absolutely, so. Very good hand on both sides, I gotta admit. So it seems like he is starting, so.
Thinking very carefully about what's his normal summon gonna be.
Yeah, he has a few options. The thing is, when you have Foxy like this, you always wonder, should I use the effect? And I think in his case, it might be the correct decision just because to have less downside with the Desires, he is actually maining multiple copies of all of the Salaman Great Traps cards, which makes the Foxy significantly more consistent. Let's see.
There it is. There's Foxy. Asking, are you going to activate that?
Yeah. He doesn't activate it. It is not surprising because he allows you. The only concern I had is that if you have the will, you do not need this. But if you do not have another extender, then you don't want to use the effect just because you're going to use the one in graveyard once you get to the Sanctuary. So.
Link summons for Salaman Great Bailings. Link materials for that are just one level 4 lower Cybers monster. So a vast majority of the Salaman Greats work with it. Or other Cybers monsters like Lady Debug.
Yeah, a very, very good card. A perfect opener.
So now, as we were saying, he's probably just gonna activate either the Sanctuary on the Will, enabling the Foxy to discard either Falco or Spinny and just start playing it out. Unfortunately, there is an impermanence in Kogi's hand, which will most likely be used on this Talio when he tries to get the Gazelle out of the deck, so...
Will of Salaman Great is activated. Gives you that extra summon once per turn, where you can cash it in for a bunch of summons all at once if you have a reincarnated Link monster. Discard Spinny to pull back Foxy from the graveyard.
And Spinny comes back up. And quick Xe summon.
And just as expected, the Stallio comes down, and I would be very surprised if the impermanence wasn't used here. So definitely thinking about it and
thinking about what to do as Chain Link 2 here. Mirage Stallio lets you summon a Salaman Great from your deck in defense position. Also has an ability when it's sent to the graveyard as material for a Salaman Great.
Just as expected, the impermanence come down. It means that Ching will not really be able to extend his plays that much this turn. So he's cut off from Gazelle, and that means It is almost impossible for him to get to an Abyss Dweller or to the Roar, for example. Luckily, he does have the Rage, which is more, as we were saying, due to the fact that he is playing a lot of traps, even Solemn Strike, which is something that we have not seen in a lot of these decks.
I kind of like the heavier traps with like the Solemns, more Rage, yeah. That sort of thing. A lot of times I feel like Salamigrate really is more of a controlling deck than an aggressive deck.
It
but,
is.
You know, what it really is something that switches almost seamlessly between the two. It's part of why it's so, its longevity is so great.
Yeah, you can definitely switch, and if you build a deck like is where you have a lot of traps, but you do put the one copy of Fusion of Fire, you're basically building a very good control deck, but a deck that really punishes you, because every time you don't have the correct interaction, then it can easily OTK you. So it is a very good deck, and no surprise that it was essentially the most represented decks for all of the past months ever since it was released. So
in North America, at least, it was about 25% of the field at all the major events.
Yeah.
Next closest deck was only around 12.
And here we go for the reincarnation Sunlight Wolf.
Mandatory here because, of course, he needs it for the Rage in his hand. And he's going to use the second effect of the Will, which is the rarest one, I'd say. You usually, first turn at least, use the other one. But it can tribute itself to check the link rating of a Salamangreat you control. And you can special summon in defense position monsters up to the rating. But here it makes sense because, as you're seeing, he didn't have another Salamangreat spell and trap in the graveyard. So by doing this, he puts more monsters on the field, and he gets the Will back. So pretty good opening here, even through the impermanence.
Basically, cost you nothing in that case. Got rid of the Will, got the Will back.
Absolutely. So. A Foxy is picked up. It's a good start, honestly. His hand is looking quite good, and the only card he has to play around is really the Rage, that's sad. And the Mind Control is a very good starting point to do that.
Checks to take a look in there. There is a Veilinx that can be banished to protect Salamangreat monsters, or cards rather, from being destroyed. That Salamangreat Rage down there does present a bit of a problem.
How will Kosaka navigate this turn?
There are a few options. One of the main differences is that, unfortunately, he's not siding or maining the Fusion of Fire, because I'm pretty sure if he was, there was actually a very good chance he could have pushed an upper game, even, with this combination of cards. Here, as expected, he's just testing the water. He doesn't know about the Rage, so he's using it to see if maybe it could have been a Roar, and then you're going to force it there. The Rage, luckily for Ching, has a second effect, so it is not completely useless at the moment, but he will be forced to tribute Salamangreat from end or field to destroy just one card, though. So
Kosaka summons Foxy, does not activate its effect. And we'll see if Chia goes ahead and uses the Rage here to stop a Link summon. Nope. Lets it go through, and Veilinx hits the field.
Yeah, it would have been too risky, and unfortunately, not having Anthrops at his disposal means that he's just going to pray that his opponent hand isn't that great, but it is much better than the previous game one, so if the previous game was enough to win, then this could just be even better. So let's see what Ching... He's gonna try and stay alive.
He's hovering that Rage. There it
okay.
is.
There it is.
He does go for it.
Keeps his monsters on field. Sends one from his hand.
And he destroys his own Sunlight Wolf. The reason being, once the Veilinx hits the field, he knows that as soon as that would have been used for Link Summon,
right.
The Rage was completely useless. So. He was kind of forced to use it there.
And now or never kind of situation, right?
Absolutely. So now, Koki is still in a perfect spot because he has Designed Mining, which is just the cherry on top, I would say, of this end.
And he knows that the only card in his opponent's hand is the sanctuary, not the sanctuary, the will.
Yes, because now he used the, he decided to use the one from the end, which is also interesting because I do get it, he gets the extra value of setting back the rage, as we're seeing, but at the same time, you're giving your opponent free information, and if they now know that there are no more interaction, you're just free to do whatever you want. So maybe I would have liked him to use a Spinny or a Foxy for it and just play mind games with
And you can see the mental math right there.
Absolutely. He's
trying to figure out what's the biggest number I can hang on him.
It could be a pretty good number, and even if it wasn't, he can go for the Abyss Dweller after cleaning the field, and we do know how good Salamon Grid is as just recycling their resources, but if they're cut off from the graveyard, not so much, because they're not famous for having a lot of cards in their hand.
They get hosed pretty hard by that Abyss Dweller. So
absolutely.
Let's see how Kazaka decides to push his hand onto the table this turn.
Abyss Dweller is a real MVP this entire season, against multiple decks even. Orcist, for example, had a real bad time.
Yes,
Abyss Dweller has been good since it's been printed. Like, it's just pretty much always been in the back of people's minds.
Yes, it was defining during Miramil format, and still probably one of the best XYZs at the moment, so...
All right, Foxy comes back from the graveyard and uses its ability to take out Sanctuary. And that's a one of. So you're not getting another one of those unless you use an ability to bring it back.
Which is never what you want to do, really, with such a card. Yeah. So just as expected, now he can go for the Stallio. He should be getting a level 4 out of it. So since, nothing too surprising here.
Now, Spinny making a reappearance?
I'm going to consider his plays quite a lot. I don't think he has enough at this point to just attack for game. It doesn't seem likely since there is a Bane Lynx as well to protect it.
Yes.
But it does have a lot of resources, so he has the ability to go for Eat Leo and just get rid of the card. He can do a lot, so... Okay, he's thinking about this Falco. He could have also just bounced back the Gazelle for next turn, so... A lot of different options, and I'm sure he will find out the perfect outcome. Thankfully, as a reminder, there is no time limit for this final. Of course, you still have to play at a reasonable pace, but at least you're not as stressed by
end of match procedure and having to calculate how you're going to navigate those last few turns.
So the Ita comes down. Okay, so he decides to pull the trigger. And
checks the graveyard and sees Sunlight Wolves. And he's asking about the face down card there. Probably, how was that card set? Was it set by an effect, etc.?
Yeah, he still has potentially the ability to go, I don't know, for Eat Leo. The order is slightly concerning, but it shouldn't make a world of a difference. Like, if he goes for Eat Leo and Dweller, potentially getting even the Roar face down, then it's a lot, so...
Take Sunlight Wolf.
Seems like he's considering entering the battle phase, but...
Even Jack Jaguar going on there.
He still has a lot. He still has both Falco and Jack Jaguar available in the graveyard, so... Doesn't seem like this... Okay, he does enter the battle phase. And just going to try and force out the Bailings,
Spinny. And I don't know that he necessarily needs to use the Bailings here. He's still got plenty of life points.
It is fair enough. He does know that the Roar is there, so... It still plays around a few cards like Ghost Ogre and Rage, so I wouldn't hate if he just kept, and that's what he's doing, makes sense.
I think it's 1850 and 2000 in there.
But now, I mean, a very convincing line of play from Koki. He still has the Memphis Chew to keep pushing and clearing everything Ching has, and he knows he has the full information at the moment of what's in his hand and face down, which... Gotta be a great feeling, honestly.
Yeah, what sort of top decks are you gonna be looking for if you're Chia right now?
Probably the one super polymerization, really. I think it is among the best ones, but it is not even, might not just be enough regardless, because as you can see, he's getting back to Gazelle for next turn, and he's most likely gonna go for an Abyss Dweller later on, so that means that even if you do clear a significant portion of the board, then you have to deal with a lot, so.
Wait, comes another Sunlight Wolf there.
Yeah.
And gets back Roar of his own.
Very cool play here, since he took his opponent's Sunlight Wolf there with Ida. He saves the reincarnation aspect and just makes a Sunlight Wolf. That way, he's considered still a summon with another one, so. Nice line of play, and we will see an Abyss Dweller soon.
We got Jack Jaguar up next.
And he gets back the Ita. Yeah. The
Ita. Okay.
Like, when you are able to get back a Ita, you feel good. Like, it means that you're so ahead that it gotta be very nice. And as expected, Eat Leo and Abyss Dweller. You just want to be sure you get back the rage into the deck. And here, the really good thing about this play is that super polymerization is not even an option anymore. He played around it by just linking away and then X-Way and summoning an X-Way Z. So,
getting that Salamandrate monster off the field.
Yes. So, tough spot, honestly. Koki playing very well and at his best. Can Xing still draw into something? It seems like very difficult here for him.
Salamangreat Raccoon, huh?
Okay, Raccoon is the one you don't see often. It allows you to protect your Salamangreats from battle, but it is not what you want to see it right now. Is he gonna negate the will here? It's really coming down to the wire. I should really hold to your seat, because this is the last place you're gonna see for this year World Championship.
Takes one more look through there.
Pass turn, and this is just a formality. You can see him shaking his head. Koki is just a few attacks away from becoming the 2019 World Champion for the TCG.
Come on, Koki.
No effect.
No effect.
Just getting everyone on board.
He goes for two attacks.
Three hit, four hit, and World Champion has been declared. Kosaka is the new World Champion.
Japan takes two World Champions this year. They won the Duel Links, they won here again. Wow.
Back with a vengeance after last year not having a finalist for Japan, and now they're taking two tournaments down. That's crazy.
You can never underestimate Japan, and they just proved it once more why they have the most World Championship wins of all time, and one more champion for them. Amazing.
From Japan. Well done. Congratulations. How are you feeling?
I feel great. Thank you so much.
Congratulations, everybody. A big round of applause.
Cookie
Osaka.
But we need
to come back. That's great, that's great, please. All right. And you can exit the stage. Yes, you can leave that there. You can leave that there if you want. Right, here we go. Here we are. Okay. In just a few moments, we'll be right back to congratulate everyone who competed today.
Did we have a good time? Excellent, excellent.
Yes.
I cannot imagine how much work and concentration and devotion it takes to become a world champion. And I am so proud to be a part of this event. I'm proud of everyone who competed. What do you think, Kaiba?
I was impressed. of course, my duel could have turned out better, but they did a good job. They should be proud.
Excellent. Well, let's once again put our hands together for everyone who competed. And for our third place duelists for the Dragon Duel, Eric Topol. Eric, come on out. There he is. For Duel Links, our third place duelist is Masaki Nita from Japan.
Come on, you guys can hang out with me. I know I lost, but you can still be my friends.
And for the trading card game, for our third place duelist, Angel Fernando Ovalu Riviera from Panama.
Nicely done. Nicely done. Yes, nicely done. I like the hat. Nicely done.
And for our second place duelists, for the Dragon Duel, Fetus Crow from Denmark. Fetus Crow. Okay.
Where are we putting these gentlemen?
I'm not sure. And the second place?
Stand on this side, yes.
Yes. And for Duel Links, Takahiro Hamada. And for the trading card game, second place, Chai Ching Wong.
Nicely done. Yes, very good. Awesome.
And our champions for the Yu-Gi-Oh! 2019 World Championship for the Dragon Duel, Sun Chang En, Taiwan.
These guys should come up front.
For Duel Links, Shuhei Kobayashi from Japan. And once again, our world champion, Kuki Kosaka. Congratulations. Everyone who made the effort to come here to lovely Berlin and make this event happen. Congratulations to you all.
It's time to duel.
All right. Kaiba? No. Not this time, Kaiba. Thank you, everyone. We hope you had a great time.
Thank you.
And we'll see you next year. All right. And everyone, let's go.
Oh, wow. I'm glad I got a chance to catch my breath there for a moment.
Absolutely, we're getting shocked. It's such a beautiful event. It was 2 days of a lot of actions, and before even more days of just going around Berlin, enjoying the moments, enjoying the atmosphere, which is always unique for the World Championship. But now, after two intense days of dueling, we have our champions, and I think we can be pretty happy with them. They're all very top-notch players, and yeah, it's just...
It's an excellent end to a season, and... Honestly, it's the craziest thing about it is the season all starts again tomorrow.
Yep.
So if you want to be the next guy on that stage, better start now.
I was just really impressed by all the deck building skills that our duelists showed this weekend. I was seeing stuff that I hadn't even considered to be possible. just for round one, for round one of the Dragon Duel even. It's just been fantastic. And our two finalists in the All Ages event really showed their stuff here. Mind Control is probably the card of the tournament.
Absolutely. Yeah. It was nearly the card of the tournament in 2018. It is by far the card of the tournament in 2019. And you got to give credit to everyone who participated. It was, again, a fantastic show, sportsmanship overall. And this guy really deserved to be both in the finals and then the champions we have. So I'm definitely happy with the results. Of course, there were a lot of good stories for the weekend. We could have gotten not one, but twice back-to-back champions. It didn't happen for neither of those guys, but still, Japan proving to be, at the moment, the most successful country with two world champions in different categories. But Taiwan is there and saying, don't forget about me. We still have a champion, and it's a good one.
Compared to the other regions, Taiwan's quite small, and the fact that it's come out so strong at these tournaments is something to definitely keep an eye on for future events. These guys played great this weekend.
They really did, and like the deck-building innovation and the show of teamwork between both the All Ages event and the Dragon Duelist from Taiwan, it, I loved it.
Absolutely. It was incredible. We never really see anyone where the pressure get the best out of them. It was a very good show of their level. And in the end, as I was saying, I'm getting chills, honestly, just by my memories for, of course, the 2017 World Championship. And just to see these images of players hugging to each other and just celebrating, not just who won, but who participated and who got to this far. So as Jerome mentioned, if you want to get here, it is possible. These guys starting from scratch, just like everyone starts from scratch. And you can get here competing with the best in the world for these amazing once-in-a-lifetime experiences.
So Marcello, will we see you on that stage next year?
This is a tough question. Me and Billy were actually contemplating doing it, so who knows? We will figure it out. I'm definitely getting chills about it. But
I wouldn't mind seeing you two team up for the 3v3 if you got a third.
Yes, that would be very cool. Maybe we could do it in either Peru or Las Vegas, where these events will be held. But for now, I will stick to doing commentary. I enjoyed it. I want to thank, of course, all of you guys who helped. And I hope that everyone enjoyed the show, both the live crowd. Again, we want to thank. So we have almost 1,000 players here celebrating with us the event, and everyone home watching and performing even at the celebration events. So,
yeah, guys, just thank you all. Honestly, we couldn't do this without you, and we're just so happy to have you here and want to play. And we'll keep doing our best to make sure that you want to come back every year.
Everyone who came out here to Berlin, thank you. Everybody watching at home, thank you. If you're back in the States and you stayed up for the first run of it, thank you too. Get some sleep. It's just been a great time.
Absolutely. And as you said, tomorrow the new season is basically beginning. We still don't know. We will figure it out where the new and 2020 World Championship will be held to. But I'm sure it will be just as great as this one, if not better. And there is so much to watch. So if you guys missed any of the cool action we had, feel free to just check our channels, both on Twitch and YouTube. You can go back and watch some of the incredible matches we had. A lot of duels, a lot of tournaments, three different ones at the same time. Really, not much to say.
You know, you can find a lot of other Yu-Gi-Oh! Content as well on our official YouTube channel. We also have replays of many other previous events, like the European Championships, like the North American World Championship qualifier. All that stuff's there. So if you want to see, how some of these players got here, you can find some of their matches online right now.
Exactly. You got to know the best players by watching this tournament. You can go back and check how they got here, how they performed throughout the entire season, throughout the years even, because most of these players didn't just pick up the game now. They've been playing it for years. And I got to say, one of the most touching, I don't know why, but personally stories is the TCG World Champion. I just put myself in his shoes. You are in 2017. Your home country in Tokyo for the World Championship. You're in the crowd. You're one of these guys here watching the tournament and supporting your friend, Ryosuke. He wins the World Championship. You're obviously happy for him. 2 years pass by. You are on the same stage, and now you lift the trophy.
All right. Well, I think that's about going to wrap it up for us. But we got one more thing to leave you with, so just hang on.
Thank you. to do, 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 do.